Good evening. This is the April 15th, 2014 meeting of the Sammamish City Council. My name is Tom Vance, and I'm honored to serve as your mayor. What's wrong?
Nothing.
That was not well timed, Kathy.
All right. Next in line then is roll call, Madam City, Madam Clerk.
Mayor Tom Vance.
Here.
Deputy Mayor Kathy
Murphy. Present.
Councilmember Don Zarin.
Here.
Councilmember Bob Keller.
Present.
Councilmember Tom O'Dell.
Here.
Councilmember Ramiro Valderrama.
Present.
Councilmember Nancy Whitten.
And here.
Okay, next is the Pledge of Allegiance, and I'm going to ask our distinguished former mayor, Don Zarin, to lead us.
I pledge allegiance
just to the flag of the United States of America
and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, thank you. Next, we need approval of the agenda.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 I want to take something off the consent calendar.
We'll get to that in a second. We don't have any student liaison reports, no presentations or proclamations tonight, as I recall, and we do not have an executive session. Mr. City Manager, no executive session tonight?
None,
okay. Next is public comment. This is an opportunity for the public to address the council, 3 minutes limit per person, or 5 minutes if representing the official position of a recognized community organization. Please give us your name and address, and I'm seeing no one, no how. Okay.
It's fun.
All right. Now we get to the consent agenda. Do I have a motion to approve the consent agenda?
I want to.
Council Member Whitten?
Yes, I'd like to remove item 3, the Inglewood Neighborhood Stormwater Retrofit Fund.
Item 3?
I have that too.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay, and we'll move that to, I guess we'll put it at the top of new business. Is that okay? All right, as amended, is there an approval for the, all in favor of the consent agenda as amended, I should say?
So moved.
I'm just asking for your vote.
All right.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Okay.
Aye. Aye.
All right. Public hearings, unfinished business. Let's go to that item number 3, which is the Inglewood Neighborhood Storm Drainage Project final design contract. You have a question? Council Member
This is embarrassing, but I don't recall specifically authorizing this. I'd like to have a review of the cost proposed. I know this is just the design contract, but I'd like to recall the total costs and also the stormwater water quality treatment.
I'll try to answer. And
the City Manager.
Thank you. And Council Member Whitten, I certainly understand there are thousands of budget items, so it's very difficult to keep track of this thing. But this is a budgeted item. It was discussed extensively. If you remember that the council asked us to look at about the 3 basins on the west side of the city. And you decided to leave the 2 alone and wait for development activity to take place to build those systems. But this is primarily the Inglewood Hill Basin. It's the existing, and this is the one that we constantly get some flooding problems. And this is the one that you budgeted as part of our capital program in the stormwater system. And
it's already in the budget.
It's already in the budget.
That's fine. I just had trouble recalling that.
Yep.
Anyone else have a question? Council Member Jarin?
Yes, Mr. City Manager. You know, we have a city policy about burying dark pipe when we put new streets in, with the expectation that maybe someday we'll have fiber to the home in this city. Is it conceivable that we're putting in 6,700 linear feet of storm drain pipe Does it make sense to bury dark pipe there too?
It probably does, Councilmember Jaron. We tried to do that primarily for sidewalks, because when you look at where you put the utilities, there's a specific locations for sanitary sewer, water, storm drainage, cable, and etc. But in this case, if the trench is wide enough, I'll ask the public works director to make sure that at the edge of the trench that we provide that particular conduit. It's a good idea to do that.
Thank you. The feasibility of that?
Right.
Okay. Yeah. Any other? Councilmember
Witt? What about putting that into our road standards?
Well, we have been implementing it. That the council direction was anytime we have a road project, we've already included. But I think it's, I don't know that we need to have some formal direction on that one, but we certainly can. As we get to the public works standards update, we can talk about it more.
Okay. Deputy Mayor Huckabee?
Yes. Do we have hydrological maps for this area?
I'm going to ask our public works director to come up to answer that question.
We've heard some concerns from public comment that.
Oh, yeah. Maybe she can address that particular issue too.
We don't have the city mapped out, hydrological maps for the city. We have areas and we have a lot of institutional knowledge about where things drain. As development comes in and additional studies, we've done some basin studies. There's more to do, and we're working hard to map our system and where our current infrastructure is. But citywide, no, we don't have it, and we don't have it at a parcel-by-parcel basis.
Would it make sense to do that in this basin while we're doing this project?
We could definitely explore that. I can look at what that would entail and report that back to the city manager.
Okay, and I will take that to the finance committee as a budget item to look at.
Okay, good. Any other questions on this? Oh, Councilmember O'Dell. Sorry.
Thank you. Don't get me wrong. I think burying dark pipe is a great idea. But I think we should probably go ahead and do it. However, before we just say go do it, I think we ought to have some visibility on the incremental cost of doing this. It may be minor, but I think our residents need to know that number.
I would say hopefully we get back some information on the feasibility that would include numbers.
Yeah, maybe I can just give a quick answer to that one. It's the... and we get back to you with more information also. It's a good question, Councilmember O'Dell, you're raising it. Anytime you put the pipe on a street or on a right-of-way, your biggest cost is your mobilization of the contractor, your trench excavation, backfilling. So let's say that a dollar per linear foot, total cost of the installation of the pipe, it's close to about the 95 cents of it is the labor, material, and equipment, trench excavation, etc. The cost of the pipe itself is very minimal in that. In this case, size of the pipe that we're going to put out there is a small conduit. I think it will be minuscule cost. That's why we have basically put that incidental cost pretty much all of our road projects to put in the open trenches. But we'll get you some exact numbers on that one.
Ben, I agree with you completely that while the ground's open, while the street's ripped up, is the time to do it. However, coming from Bowling Land, where we look at incrementals, there is still going to be both material cost increment and also a time cost, because somebody has to put this stuff together, and that's where the big cost will be, not the materials.
And the other part is, because this is a storm drainage, it has to be a separate accounting for that one. I mean, in the road projects, it comes from the general fund. Storm drainage operates on an enterprise revenue. We'll find out, but I suspect the cost of the pipe itself is going to be probably less than $15,000, $20,000, but I'll have the public works director to get that number to us out of million-plus dollar job.
Councilmember Valderrama.
I'm curious, we've been talking about the storm drainage issues that we have on Englewood Hill Road, on Thompson Road, and then the third one that we have was the 228th area. Will this cover the problems that we have on storm water drainage on Englewood Hill Road, or is it a partial down payment on it, or where do we stand?
Laura, refresh my memory what the council directed us to do when we reviewed this one. And I don't remember, Romero. It's been a while, so I'll ask.
I apologize if you could repeat the question. I just found out that there's no sound on the streaming for the website, so I was trying.
So obviously, this is one of the three main projects, Inglewood Hill Road, Thompson Hill Road, 228, that we've been talking for storm drainage. And what I'm asking is this project that we're now talking about approving for stormwater drainage, is this what will finalize Inglewood Hill Road, or is this a partial down payment for stormwater drainage? Where does it fit as far as?
So this would be the project to take care of the Inglewood, all the stormwater on Inglewood, and it handles that basin of the Inglewood area. All the neighborhood would drain down to that, and this would collect all that water. So this money is for the design. The full construction cost was put in the CIP, and our storm rates reflect that. And it's a little over $1 million.
That's correct. So this is now the design for all of Inglewood Hill Road.
Design and permitting for the entire project.
Okay. Any further questions? Councilmember Keller.
I'd like to add on to that. We talked about this in, as well as...
I don't know.
I do remember that.
Yes.
Yeah.
As some of rereading this material, my question really is an extension of Councilmember Valderrama, in that how is this a main pipe that goes down that could be a conveyance for other areas? Is this pipe big enough that you would actually use it beyond the scope of what we're actually looking for right now?
But let me maybe jump in here. If my memory is correct, and it doesn't fail me, this particular basin, it's full of private streets and pretty much no functional storm drainage system. And our standards require about a 1,500 square foot or threshold for the new constructions, and then you get this individual homes, and the impervious surface coverage is 1,500 square foot, 1,500 square foot. Individually, they don't have an impact, but the cumulative impact is getting bigger.
Or 2,000.
Right. By the time you put the drivers and et cetera, driveways. I think that the council member, we reviewed this extensively with the council last year. Mm-hmm. There were three basins that council wanted to do some preliminary work. This was one of them. What this one does is puts trunk lines in the private systems there, or it comes to the extension of the private systems, but the people still have to extend the line to connect to it as the new construction occurs. Right now, it would be so unreasonable to ask any new single-family homeowner to build a completely brand new system and take it all the way down to the lake. And so this is a retrofit. I wish we would have been incorporated 15, 20 years ago. We could have fixed these problems. So this is the problem that we've been dealing with for a long time, and this was a direction of the council to basically start the design phase right now. And we put the overall project in the Storm Drainage Capital Fund, CIP fund, that program. That's what Laura is talking about. And the construction is scheduled when on this one? Refresh my memory, Laura.
We anticipate requesting construction dollars in the 15-16 budget cycle.
All right. Tom?
Rodell. Just a comment. Last night during the public comment period of the Committee of the Whole meeting, we did have a comment on this particular problem in this area. And we're seeing in the last 2 years a number of applications for construction in the Inglewood Hill Basin, which has not had as much activity as it has had lately. There's still a fair number of undeveloped plots in this area, so if it's been a problem before, it's only going to get worse, so this is the time to do it.
And it wasn't just last night that we've heard comments.
I know,
we've heard others as well. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right. And Laura, while you're at it, the particular comments that we heard regarding a development, tell us the process that you're going through to make sure that the storm drainage is not diverted from one basin to another basin. I think the council member Huckabee was primarily asking that question, or part of her question was that if we don't have hydrological maps for entire city, how do you deal with these individual applications that come here for a permit?
So the developer actually provides a study to us telling us where all the water goes on their site existing and where it's proposed to go in the future. We keep records of all drainage complaints, concerns we've received, and we have staff, knowledgeable staff, who are very familiar with the area. They review the reports that come in. They go out and verify the data that was provided. The particular development in question, we've actually rejected their report and returned it to the developer, saying that it's not, they have not answered or they've not provided the right information, and we believe there are a number of errors, technical errors. Then once we've agreed, accepted their report, at that point, before we would shift water from one basin to another, we would go through a number of iterations to make sure that there would be no adverse impacts, either by diverting, taking water away from one, or by adding to the other. So we go through a pretty extensive, and if we get to a place where there's a lot of disagreement, we will even call in a third party reviewer to give us an independent opinion.
And that rejection was done before the public comment was presented to the council. So it wasn't that the public comment triggered that particular rejection. That was done some time ago.
Thank you.
Thank you, Laura.
Okay. Anything further? Let's move on to item number 5 in new business. This is an ordinance, first reading, amending chapters 14A.05 and 14A.15 of the Sammamish Municipal Code, amending the impact fee waiver provision and adjusting the impact fees for streets. Mr. City Manager?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'm going to ask our Assistant City Manager and Public Works Director, Laura Philpott, to give you, if that's okay with you, Mr. Mayor.
Point of order. I don't believe we voted on this authorization on this number 4.
That's what I was saying.
This resolution requires a vote.
3.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
3.
Number 3 hasn't been voted on.
Unless you want to wait till next week.
That's right. Then let's go back and pick up on item number 3. Do you have a motion to approve?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, now back to 5.
Go ahead, Laura.
Thank you. I'm glad we got that approved. So, good evening. I'm here to talk about the ordinance and the packet. This is a first reading related to impact fees within the city. There are two areas I plan to cover tonight. One is the street impact fee rate change. This is implementing comprehensive plan changes that were done in 2013, and then some modifications to our affordable housing exemptions. This is both for streets and parks. If it's all right with the mayor and council, I'd like to combine both items 5 and 6 into one presentation. So our street impact fee revisions, again, this is resulting from the 2013 transportation level of service revisions. Our methodology in the way we calculate has not changed at all. These changes are, our street impact fee is based on a concurrency project list, and the project list is what changed based on the level of service revisions in our comprehensive plan. The rates have been unchanged since 2006. What is proposed in the ordinance is a decrease of 4.4%, and I'll explain that a little bit more here. Some changes that were made to the list specifically were two projects were removed, the East Lake Sammamish Parkway, two phases of East Lake Sammamish Parkway, and then added in was the Town Center project of Southeast 4th Street. The other adjustment was the updating the project cost to reflect current construction dollars, whereas previously the inflation factor had not been added. In fact, it was brought before the City Council for consideration in 2013, but the decision was to wait until we made the level of service modifications when East Lake Sammamish Parkway came off, and we would do the change to fees one time. So the actual street impact fee revision, again, none of the methodology is being adjusted, but the 2006 numbers as adopted are shown, which is $14,706 for a trip fee. And then so what we're proposing is the new rate would be $14,063. Again, we're removing the costs associated with East Lake Sammamish Parkway, and we're adding the cost from Southeast 4th Street. Jeff Bronze, our city engineer, just came in. I just want to, he's the one who's actually done all of the calculations for us on this. So it's a pretty extensive spreadsheet and methodology that went through, and I appreciate what he
did. Is that why his door was locked for about the 3-4 days?
Yes, it's exactly why.
Laura, before you move on, could you just explain the difference between these two rates?
So per trip is what the first number is. So that the ITE, Institute of Transportation Engineers, it's an international standard, comes up with what does each land use create as far as number of trips when it's developed. And a single family house creates 1.1 trips. So that's why it's a little bit higher than the actual rate, because it's it includes an increment higher than one trip, and that's for the PM peak hour is what the rate is calculated based on.
Thank you.
So moving on to affordable housing, in addition.
Councilmember Whitten?
Was there any change to multifamily?
The entire fee table is in the packet, and that is on page attachment A5. And
so all in the back.
So when the trip rate, so the were you able to find that table?
14, exhibit 2.
Table 14, yes.
It's on table 14.
It's an attachment A5.
Attachment A5.
Okay, that's two pages here, and then there's an attachment A6, A-6.
Well, you have something different than what I have.
Well, table 14 is the same.
No, oh, okay. We have the same
14.
Thing.
Yeah.
So you see we did the strike through and then added the new rates. So multifamily is adjusted in it.
Oh, okay.
So all of the land use have been adjusted, but you see we didn't change any of the other items in the table. This was just an adjustment based on the fee, based on the changes done at the Planning Commission and at the City Council last year.
Project total cost has changed, thus all the fees have changed. Okay. And we don't have a luxury of playing with the funding formula that is built into the overall methodology, how we calculated the impact fees. And we didn't want to hire $200,000 additional consultant fees to go through a change in the methodology, because we haven't heard that the council's concerned with the methodology before. So
back to the
Parkway projects are out, Southeast 4th Street in. Project cost estimates are revised to reflect the current conditions. Same methodology reflects new fees.
The methodology itself was, we were a model for all the other jurisdictions.
We spent 3 years developing that methodology.
Councilmember Jaron?
Is that what we paid Randy Young, a couple hundred thousand to do that?
Well, Randy's portion was close to 78,000, but we had other consultants were involved, but we spent a lot of time on this.
So my question is, are you going to answer some of the questions I had emailed in, or should I bring them up now?
We had provided, can you come that out? We can talk about those right now. So some of the questions you asked.
Are there slides that would help answer those, or should,
is
this the right time?
We don't have slides on those. We'd send out an email to the entire council, but I'd be happy to go over those here tonight. So the first one was on affordable housing. The second one was on affordable housing, and then you had a question about trip generation. The city does. You asked about the park and ride lot, right?
Well, yeah. Basically, I'm saying the ITE table is fine for a general table, but this is a specific city. We have unique transportation patterns, and for I set out a couple examples. For example. A hardware store. Well, we know the example of the hardware store very well. So right now, because we don't have a hardware store, we have to go down to Issaquah or Redmond to do that trip. Whereas if we had the hardware store here, there would be fewer vehicle miles traveled. And so to me, that's a negative impact rather than a positive. And I brought this up before. We're choosing to simply use the ratios that this table is provided by the Institute. And I don't think that's reflects the actual on the street incident here in Sammamish.
So I have two-part answer to that. The first part is the trip length factor. If you look in the table in our impact fee rates, there's a trip length factor. Mm-hmm. And so the 0.29, which is listed for a number of the land uses, all the commercial uses, is specific to Sammamish, and it is lower. And that was part of that methodology and part of the dollar consultant's help that our city manager referred to in 2006. The other piece to that is our code specifically calls out, has language provisions saying that if a traffic study is provided to us for that specific land use, that the fee can be adjusted based on the specific needs or for that in this particular location. For us to go through and do an independent study for each of these land uses for Sammamish would be quite an undertaking.
I think the council member, Jaron, raised this issue at the time we developed this particular table. Based on that concern, we adjusted the trip's lengths. So if some normal trip is paying $10, it's adjusted to $2.90 in this case.
I had forgotten about the discretion of the staff in individual cases.
And if there's somebody else have a better data to show us that it could issue the actual less than that,
okay,
we're open to seeing the traffic studies.
Good. Thank you.
I have a question.
First, Councilmember Rodell.
Okay, thank you. Along the same theme, I'm looking again at Exhibit 1. I'm focused on single-family house with an ITE trip ratio of 1.01, apartment of 0.62, and low-rise condo townhouse. 0.78. These are approximately a quarter of the way down on the page. If these are standard ratios, and what I just thought I heard to say is they fundamentally are, there are very few single residence apartments or condominiums in Sammamish. The people that are living in condos and apartments appear by and large are families that have financially can't afford anything else, or are in a divorce situation, or the spouse has left or passed away. And therefore, I think the trip ratio might be more like the typical family, as opposed to the young singles. We don't have any young singles up here, at least not very many of them, that are out on their own. So my question is, have we tinkered with it to take that into account?
We have not done an independent study on the multifamily land use trip generation, no.
Okay, so this might be understated.
Deputy Mayor Huckabee.
Oh, I have my hand up first.
Yeah. Yeah, we're trying to get to a particular point here. I'll get to you in just a second.
Thank you.
We're beginning to discuss the methodology, and I think a lot of us have questions about line by line, but that seems to be a totally different topic. And maybe at some point we can discuss when it's appropriate to look at changing the methodology in the future as opposed to talking about line by line here tonight.
Thank you, Deputy Mayor. The challenge that we have is whatever ordinance and fee schedule we develop, that has to withstand the legal challenges. And that's where that you have to depend on the national standard to make some localized adjustments. When we made these adjustments, we had a good justification transportation modeling to show the internal trips, how we come to this 29% adjustment, 22% adjustment. If we want to go back and redo the table, that is a major undertaking, Council, and we can't do that right here. And if that's your desire, then we need to put in a work program to do it. At this point, my suggestion is not to do that.
Let's try to stick to the resolution or the ordinance in front of us and go with it. Did you have another question?
Or?
Councilmember Whitten?
What happens when the ITE trip generation schedules get updated? Do we do any adjustments there? I understand that we have a citizen advocating for more density in the town center based on some updates.
Well, I think the citizens advocating it based on a one particular case study. It's in the city of Bellingham area that we need to take a look at that one. Yeah. IT is a national standard. We continually update that. We continually rely on that one. But I'm going to turn it over to engineers. My engineering license is pretty rusty on that issue. So
that overlaps both with concurrency as well as these fees.
Right. Yes.
So our city engineer Jeff Bronze just and I were just discussing that Ben was answering, and we do look at what the updates are. There have not been any significant changes in the IT. Again, as Ben mentioned, this is a national standard, so it would take probably a significant change to bump those numbers.
Each land use depends on almost 100 to 250 studies. You guys refresh my memory in the IT rates.
Jeff Braun, city engineer, it really varies by the land use. Some, like your single family home, has very large number of studies, whereas there's
thousands
and then there's some newer trip generation, like a specialty coffee shop or something. Some of these new trip generations that come out in the updated manuals will maybe only have a dozen studies, and they give a little warning if there's a low number of studies.
But you do have a standard variations that you look at it to make sure that it's a reliable, statistically valid number, and et cetera, right?
Correct. The manual provides all that.
And it has been already tested in the court system, hasn't it?
I assume so, yes.
Is that a national standard that all cities develop impact fee rely on that?
Every city I know relies on that manual.
Okay, thank you.
We're being cross-examined.
Do you have more slides?
Yes, because there is a second part to the ordinance this evening, which is the Affordable Housing Impact Fee Code. And this relates to both streets and parks. And I want to thank Arthur Sullivan from ARCH for coming here tonight to help answer any questions that may come up. So in 2012, there was a House bill at the state level, House Bill 1398, that modified the revised code of Washington. So prior to that revision, the state law allowed cities to provide exemptions for low-income or affordable housing. So for example, that $14,000 impact fee for affordable housing, the city could waive a portion or all of that. However, they would have to fund that from a different fund, meaning we would have to take it from general fund or some other source and put it into the impact fee pot of money. So it's taking out of one pocket and putting in the other. So the law was changed in 2012, which allows cities, local agencies now, to provide those exemptions without moving money from one pocket to the other up to 80%. So up to 80% of the fee can be exempted. When we were looking at the state law, there were a couple other adjustments. We worked with our legal counsel and we did some modifications to the definition of affordable housing. So that's also reflected in here. So we're trying to focus this update just on the state law and being consistent with the new state law, not again changing the methodology or the underlying code that exists. So here is the table. There were some questions Councilmember Jaron brought up related to the table.
Which page and are we on the table?
The table is in
A2.
Thank you.
The portions that are redlined under the affordable housing is just taking that language, instead of having a definition in two places, it was removed from here and relied upon in the definition section of the code. The other change that was made is where it says impact fee reduction, 50 to 90% is what it was previously if you were a low income for 5 units or more. And then it was up to 50% for the first four units if you were moderate income. And after consulting with ARCH and looking at our upcoming Habitat for Humanity project, we wanted to give that flexibility to be consistent with the new state law of the 80% reduction. And so that's where we're making the recommendation to change that and that only. Making changes beyond that to this table would require going through the Planning Commission, and I understand their workload is, their calendar is a little full right now. So again, it's focused on just making this minor adjustment to be consistent.
Councilmember Whitten.
So the reason that was per suggestion recommendation by our legal counsel, and that is because that is defined under the section of definitions, and that is under attachment A1, page 1 of attachment A. That's included in the definition section, and they felt that was a more appropriate place rather than having things defined in a table as well as in the definition section.
That makes a great deal of sense.
Councilmember Jarrett has a question.
So my question was, why are we penalizing people for doing more than four? That's not saying we have to change it now. I just wanted to understand the motivation for that.
Some of the discussions we had, because we had kind of making sure we understood this correctly, was were they being penalized for having more than four units? And for example, one of the examples that came up with is there was a very large development in Town Center where they're required to do 10% of affordable housing. They'll have more than five units, so they'll have some responsibility to pay. But a smaller development, such as Habitat for Humanity, we have the flexibility to provide a higher exemption for them when the development is solely based on affordable housing. But Arthur is here if he could maybe help address that.
Arthur, we may need you to help on this one. Coming up there, sir.
Evening, Arthur Sullivan, Program Manager of ARCH. Remember, we were trying to keep this to non-substantive changes in this go-round. When you first looked at this 4 or 5 years ago, the concern was because of the old state law that if you did have higher than 50%, you have to do that transfer that was just described by the Public Works Director. And the concern was that moderate income for a larger project, at that time, the council felt they didn't want to give a full fee waiver because of the potential fiscal implications for moderate level housing, where they were willing to go higher for lower income level housing. So it was based on that old state law and driving. So you could, without a fiscal impact today, change that to a higher percentage, but then it would require, because it's a substantive change, a different process. So that may be something for a future revisit where you might want to revisit that, because the state law would result in less fiscal impact to you if you were to change that. But just because of the procedures now, we didn't propose it for now.
So Arthur, Habitat for Humanity is going to be, I think, 10 units, isn't it? But so why don't we have it going up to 80% for five or more units of moderate housing also?
So the Habitat project, just to clarify, will have low and maybe some moderate.
I see.
So we're hoping that with this count, they might have five units at moderate, but we're thinking it's probably going to be four, because it says a majority will be low income. And since it's only expected to be around 10 units, we think we're pretty close to having them pretty fully covered without triggering the substantive issue that was brought up at the beginning.
But it still begs the question of why we're penalizing a project for putting in more than four units. I don't understand that.
And I think I would suggest, as we do the comp plan and we come back, that's an area that we could target, just like if you look at your impact fee formula again, this would be something to put on the table at that time.
Okay.
And I think that Councilmember Jaron, the old state law would not give us an option of waiving the fees.
Right.
And we were looking at it, how much we can actually have the general fund to write the checks for the exemptions that we provide in our ordinance. You wanted to keep that at the moderate level. With the new law, we can make substantive changes, but if we get into that, then we have to go through the whole planning commission process. So we're trying to walk within the fine lines.
And I do believe the housing code will be back before the city council for review under the comprehensive plan process.
Councilmember O'Dell.
I'm looking at the column labeled impact fee reduction, the second column. And there are ranges in there, like just taking the first one up to 100%. And then the others are 50 to 80%, up to 50%, up to 80%, 0 to 50%. Who and how is it determined what the real number is going to be?
The code says that it will be determined by the community development in consultation with the community development director in consultation with the public works director. So that would be whoever replaces Cameron and myself reading the application and making. Cameron and I had discussed right before he left is putting together some guidelines so that we can make we would be how this was applied, but that's something that we hadn't finalized, and we continue to look at getting that finalized and present that to the city manager for his.
Okay.
That's all I had for this evening. This is a first reading of the ordinance. We'll have two separate ordinances, one with this.
Yes, we're considering both 5 and 6 here at this.
One for parks. And we do plan to bring them both back on May 6th for the second reading, because these aren't substance changes. We do not require a public hearing. And the traffic impact fee portion had a significant public hearing and a public involvement process last year for the comprehensive and level service changes. So that's all I had tonight. If there's further questions.
Mr. City Manager.
Mayor, if there's something that you need to want us to change besides to obviously look at this, the bigger issue, which we will come back as part of the comprehensive plan. Unless there's no changes, my intent is to put this in the consent calendar for the second reading because we got a full agenda coming. So if there's some issue that council wants me to make some change and address it right now, it's maybe a good time to address that.
There further?
Yeah.
Councilmember O'Donnell?
I'd like a little further clarification of the criteria that the community development director and the public works director are going to use. I just don't want them going to the max all the time or not doing anything all the time. I'd like to know what the decision process is.
Yeah, and that's a very good question, Councilmember O'Dell. It has to be based on some sort of a study. That has to be a traffic study to start with. But there are a couple of things. We haven't given any exemptions, to my knowledge, till today. That hasn't happened. I don't expect that to happen in anything in the immediate future, but there's something that we need to establish a criteria. The intent was, as you looked at the housing strategies and the other comp plan items, we want to come back to you with some sort of a criteria, because I want to have that criteria blessed by the council to make sure that we're uniformly meeting all applicants throughout the process.
Deputy Mayor Huckabee.
Don't we have to wait until we get our new community development director, or is there Habitat project moving along there?
Then I will, are you done with your presentation? I'm going to offer the opportunity for public comment on either of these two ordinances. If there's anyone in the audience who'd like to speak concerning these, Arthur, you? Anyone else? Okay, then we are finished with public comment. Councilmember Whitten?
I'll answer that question probably better when I spoke, and it's a very good question. Prior to the change of the state law, the federal fund had to write a check for the amount of exemptions.
Now, with this, the change of the law, that gives us more flexibility. When you look at the most of our transportation projects, the funding for the projects comes from multiple sources. General fund, grant monies, impact fee monies, developer frontage improvements, et cetera. Now we have an opportunity to distribute that to shortcomings in the many different fronts than just the general fund.
Okay, that was items 5 and 6. I didn't read the ordinance, the first reading amending chapter 14A20 of the Sammamish Municipal Code, Impact Fee for Parks and Recreation Facilities, and to revise the exemption for affordable housing. These will come back to us the first week of May and in the second reading. Okay?
I'm taking notes here that some of the comments that you raised, and we'll try to address that as part of our compliance amendment process to see what we need to do. Further details.
Okay, we'll move to item number 7, ordinance, first reading related to parks and recreation, is specifically retitled chapter 7.12. I'm not going to read all of these, but there's a whole bunch of changes to the code, and I'm going to ask the city manager to.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. This is something that the, our park commission work on and our park staff work on to clean up some of the things in our code. So I'm going to turn it over to our Parks and Recreation Director, Jesse Bond.
Two days in a row.
Nice job, Ben.
To give us a staff report.
Thank you. Well, as you can see by the amazing turnout tonight, these ordinances are really exciting topics. I will mention Carrie's here tonight, our attorney, and she's been working very closely with us on this and has probably done more research on boating and swimming regulations than she'd ever care to. I also have Hank Klein here tonight, the chair of our park commission, and he would be happy to provide comments in terms of the parks commission recommendation. So I think what I'm going to do, I chatted with Ben in the hallway earlier, we have quite a few items to discuss tonight. I think it might be easier to just discuss them one at a time. So bear with me. By the way, some entertainment. I did include some photos of all taken from our parks. You can guess which one they come from as we go. So this is an overview. This is our first reading tonight, essentially addressing two items, parks and boating regulations. They will be presented to you again for a second reading and hopefully adoption at the next council meeting. And as Laura mentioned, I'm going to talk about them together tonight, but when we bring them back for adoption, they'll be addressed separately.
Okay.
My presentation is grouped into four categories. I found it was easiest to tackle them by category. So general administrative changes, swimming and boating changes, one section on responsibilities and enforcement, and then one new section on prohibition of tobacco. So just a quick overview. I'm not going to go over any of these cleanup items except to note that we're proposing to change section 7.12, the title, from rules for use of facilities to park rules. It's really what it is. And then we're cleaning up a whole bunch of code language. And this is from our early days of incorporation. So things like changing the word manager to director, division to department, and so on. I'll also note that we've had a definition in our ordinance that defines associated marine areas, and we've added that in several areas of the ordinance. So again, I'm not going to go over these, but if you read the ordinance, you'll notice these changes are throughout.
Any questions on that? Okay.
Great. Okay. So the way I structured this is in your packets, I think everyone received a matrix. If you'd like to follow along, the way I set these slides up is at the very top it says page 2 and then item number 12, so you know exactly what I'm referring to as we work through these. And I've grouped them again by category, so we'll jump around just a little bit. So our first change, recommended change, has to do with pets and city park facilities, which you know we... is never a hot topic in my department. Basically, our current code says that dogs, pets, and other domestic animals are prohibited, are not are not permitted in certain areas of the park, and our current code identified swimming beach, picnic areas, and play areas. We have added athletic fields, and we have clarified that picnic areas actually should say picnic shelter areas.
Okay.
And we have also added associated marine areas. So the language was there. We just served to clarify where pets are allowed and not allowed. Question?
Associated marine areas would include then the docks?
Yes.
Okay, just for clarification.
Councilmember O'Dell.
Jesse, do we have or are we contemplating any picnic areas that are not sheltered?
We already have.
No, and that's why we put this language in, because we, I mean, conceivably our entire park system is a picnic area. Mm-hmm. So a picnic or play area was a little bit too vague. We wanted to specify that pets and animals are not allowed specifically in the shelter areas, but I'm not recommending we restrict any other areas of our parks.
Deputy Mayor Huckabee.
Jesse?
Yes.
Would the associated marine area be the walkway south of the landing, which is away from the picnic area and has several little spots where one can sit and put their feet in the water? And I see a lot of people down there with dogs in the water over in those areas. So is that also inclusive when you talk about marine area?
Yes, and this is going to come up quite a bit tonight, so let me just read the definition.
Okay.
Associated marine area means any water area within 100 feet of any City of Sammamish trail, open space, park area, or marine facilities such as dock, pier, float, buoy, log boom, or other object which is part of a City of Sammamish park area, provided that such area does not include private property. And we had a pretty lengthy discussion about this at the Parks Commission meeting. I think there's certainly a desire for owners of dogs to have a place for their dogs to swim. What I will tell you is Sammamish Landing is not a place where we can allow that. And the reason is that park was designed on a very sensitive shoreline. And when we got our permits, which took 2 years, we were only allowed to build pocket beaches. Mm-hmm. And we committed to preserving the rest of the vegetation and the sensitive shoreline. So what I shared with the Parks Commission is, yes, I'm aware that people do go down with their dogs. We monitored the use over last summer and found that we were able to maintain the vegetation. If it becomes a problem, and we start to see habitat being destroyed down there, I will probably be coming back and having a different conversation with you about prohibiting dogs altogether. So for right now, they're not allowed. I know it happens, as you know, do other things. But that's why this regulation is in place.
What did you say? Those are Redmond dogs.
Yes, they are. I'm just
now they're coming up for Mystic Quest.
Okay.
Vengeance.
Any further questions here? Councilmember Jaron had a question.
Yeah, Jesse, I think we're setting ourselves up for passing an ordinance that we're not going to enforce. And when you say that domestic animals are not allowed in the athletic field, I'm thinking of the concerts in the park at Pine Lake. A whole lot of people that come to that concert have their dogs with them, under control, that they have them with. And if we're not going to enforce it, why are we changing the ordinance?
So I knew at some point enforcement of dogs was going to come up tonight. And what I would advocate as your parks director is we should focus tonight on what are the right policies and regulations for our parks. Enforcement is a different animal. I personally think we need to do more. I've actually been talking about it. Dogs on, just letting dogs run free for all on athletic fields is really problematic in our park system. They're not allowed at all on the synthetic turf fields. On our regular athletic fields, you know, trying to maintain these areas, level playing surfaces. We also have kids out rolling in the dirt and mud, and we have issues of sanitation when we dogs. Pine Lake Park is the one park that's not fenced, so it becomes kind of an open area, grass area, dog area. Our other fields are fenced enough that we can close them and dogs stay off. So I would really, it would be my preference that we maintain. I forgot how we can do better enforcement.
I'm just looking ahead at the concert. I can see someone coming up to someone with a dog that's doing no harm or bothering anybody and saying, hey, that's illegal, get out of here.
Can we exempt Pine Lake Park for the concert?
Well, that's another question. Councilmember Keller? Another question on this issue?
I'll just mention Pine Lake Ball Field is the only ball field that sort of has this dual purpose. All of your other athletic fields are athletic fields. That's how they're used and played.
We could exclude it by the defining athletic field not to include something that's multi-purposed.
That's your desire, or again, I think there's a degree. Right, I can tell you I would not enforce dogs on the Pine Lake ball fields at concerts. Prefer to see an exclusion, or would you prefer me to manage it through?
I prefer you to keep the regulation and let's see if we can enforce it better. Any other?
Yeah, it goes.
It's not a trial. We're keeping what exists.
No dogs in Pine Lake Park.
Theoretically.
I don't agree with that.
Councilmember Valderrama. No, I follow a similar line of thinking as Councilmember Witten. I'd be curious to hear, since we have Hank Klein from the Parks Commission here, what the thinking of the Parks Commission was as Pine Lakes came into this discussion, if we can hit that.
Before you do that, Hank, how was the game last night?
Don't want to know.
That was the answer.
I'm sorry I missed it. I was the answer.
I'm sorry you missed it too. You were better off, man.
Is there a correlation?
I think Parks Commission echoes Jesse's comments that there's a necessity to create an all-encompassing regulation. And that's why we need to keep it in here. The enforcement issue is probably a better way to deal with it. She said, you know, the difficulty is with the health issues associated with animals on athletic fields. I don't think, correct me if I'm incorrect, Jesse, but it doesn't say dogs are not allowed at Pine Lake Park. It says they're not allowed on the athletic field, the swimming areas, and the shelter areas, but there are other places that dogs are allowed on, each within the park itself. So what we're trying to do is regulate in areas that are more common to use by people. Where we might have some health issues and other issues as well.
Pine Lakes Park would not be covered by this.
Deputy Mayor Eckerbeck, you're next.
Yes, I'd like to add some comments because we've had a lot of experience over the years. We operate the ice cream booth. So our Kiwanis Club is there pretty regularly. We're right next to the Rotary booth. And frankly, dogs and little children. And from observations over the years, little children will have a popsicle or something, and then there's the dog, and then you have dogs doing what dogs do, and I think there's a sanitary issue. So I would like to keep that enforcement in place so that it is family friendly for all families.
Councilmember O'Dell.
Thank you. This goes back to my earlier question to Jesse about picnic areas that were not sheltered. Frankly, when you have a concert at Pine Lake Park, the whole thing is one big picnic area. And Kathy, I agree with you that little kids and food and dogs are asking for incidents.
Just to put my own two cents in, I really do think that our parks have to be accessible and usable by all families, not just the ones that have dogs. And I've seen many occasions when somebody with two or three dogs, tend to spoil a time for other folks. So I'm not anti-dog or anything, but I prefer to keep the language as it is. I'm not sure Pine Lake is under consideration. We're not. This is the first reading, so I think you'll have a chance to deliberate on this next time. I think I'm seeing at least one, two, three. Do I see a fourth person who likes the regulations as they are?
Think about it.
Well, then we don't have a consensus, and so it'll stay the same until we meet again. Continue on.
Tafa, for my park director, who's a dog lover, she loves dogs.
I know that.
So this is a really tough pictures for her, too.
Of her dog. So
I'm a dog lover, too.
We have pictures of Lucy in this presentation.
Okay. Well, let's continue to the next issue.
Better not be at Pine Lake
Park. Make a note that this one will come back for discussion. Moving on, so page 2, item number 13, and I'm still working off the matrix. This is just expanding existing language of our code. Our code currently says that if you have a dog or a pet or a domestic animal in our park, that your animal may not, specifically it says, molest or annoy park visitors. We added language that says, or other pets or domestic animals or wildlife. So basically we just said if you're going to bring a creature into our park on a leash, it needs to be under control and respectful of all beings there.
Councilmember Whitten.
Question.
Okay, what about our neighbor who has a dog that barks at every other dog?
Not fall under this
language is so broad.
These are park rules specific to cities' parks, so it doesn't address things that are happening outside of our park limits.
Other questions? Okay.
Well, that's I don't agree with that language. I'd like our city attorney. I mean, if I just read this out of context, in the context that's shown here, anybody permits his pet or dog to bark continuously or otherwise, because if you have a dog on the outside perimeter, barking continuously, yeah, it surely disturbs the peace and tranquility of people in the park area. I may address Councilmember Wood's question. To the extent we are able to enforce this code, our enforcement authority is only on our own city property. So we wouldn't be able to go to a private property owner and in any way ask them to restrain their dog from barking or whatever it is that's creating an annoyance. We can only enforce these rules as to city-owned park property.
Okay.
Well, just one other point on that. Big Rock Park, we've had complaints from the neighbors that people going through the park with their dog will upset the neighbor's dog. So it would apply here then that you're annoying other pet or domestic animals. Even though they're outside the park, you're annoying them. You're in the park and you're annoying them outside the park. So is that a violation then? Is that what you were saying?
Well, it's, I think, more appropriately covered by this code language, that scenario that you just described.
Mm-hmm.
Again, with regards to enforcement, the ability to enforce this is another issue, as Jesse's pointed out, but the intent is for people that bring their creatures, as Jesse put it, their pets to parks, the intent is to have those animals be under control and to not in any way interfere with other people's enjoyment of the park. It's hard to enforce with regards to adjacent private property owners, so that is going to be an enforcement challenge and likely very difficult to address. In all cases.
Okay, let's continue. Councilmember Callan, any more questions? I know.
I agree with you, Council Member Keller, that it is a subjective term. There's no way to quantify that in an objective, measurable way. But again, the intent behind it is the word annoy in sort of the common, ordinary sense of that term. And I think when it comes to enforcement, we're going to use a reasonable approach when it comes to enforcement. And so, you know, I don't know what level that has to rise to. Again, it's a subjective standard, but we've done our best here to try to capture that this language will actually broader than what it is currently. But if you can look at this slide, you'll see that the words molest or annoy are in the existing code that's been in place for quite some time. And I'm not aware of any issues with this language based on our current practices. Are you, Jesse? I'm not aware. So that is the current language of the code.
Okay. Go on over this slide.
Continuing to work off your matrix, page 4, item number 26. Page 4 of your matrix, item number 26. If you visit our parks, we have a number of signs that say you may not feed
for the tape, Nancy.
Is that Pine Lake Park?
Okay.
The boardwalk. The picture.
That is Evans Creek Preserve.
Evans Creek Preserve, okay.
Yes. this is really simple. We do not have language prohibiting the feeding of wildlife. We have added it. Has it been a number of signs, but it was never captured in our code. And we believe it is in the best interest of not only the wildlife, but the safety of our patrons, too.
Don't feed the bears?
That would be recommended.
Yes. Okay, any other questions on that? I think that's pretty clear. Let's go to the next slide.
I'm going to jump topics now and switch to swimming and boating. So I'm going to ask you to flip back to page 1. These are definitions. Our very savvy attorney, Carrie, as she was working with us on these ordinance updates, noted that we had two definitions that were missing. One was a flotation device, and one was motor-powered craft or watercraft, which is referenced in numerous places. Our ordinance.
And I just want to add for the council's benefit that the definitions, I did not make these up, these were actually borrowed from state law. RCW Chapter 79A.60, which is the regulation of recreational vessels. And so these are substantially based on definitions used.
Okay. Any questions? Councilmember Rodell?
Thank you. One for Carrie. I wrote down paddle boats. Are they covered here, or do they need to be specifically called?
We do have the proviso in there regarding non-powered craft. We say include but not limited to, and we have examples of canoes, kayaks, rowboats, immersions, but your paddleboat example is a good one. We weren't trying to have an exhaustive list here. It was just meant to give some examples, but you're right that that would be included in the non-motorized watercraft category.
I might want to throw that in just so it's not a loophole.
We can certainly throw that in, but again, this list was not intended to be exhaustive.
Understand.
Okay.
Okay.
Have that.
Next slide.
Okay, page number 3 of your table, item number 17. Build a section, and we moved it. So some of this language is not new. Basically, it says designated swim areas need to be designated by buoys or log booms or other markers, which we do at both Pine Lake Park and Sammamish Landing Park. Swimming is only permitted within swimming areas. The important thing to note about this section is it prohibits swimming at the north dock of Sammamish Landing Park. And I'm going to get into some slides here where I'm specifically talking about Sammamish Landing. So what I wanted to remind you, I wish we had a better graphic. This is Sammamish Landing Park and the docks. And these docks were designed very specifically with specific purposes. So this is the larger dock. We call this the South Dock. This dock was designed primarily to accommodate swimmers. And this dashed red line indicates where the swim line sits right now. This dock over here, during our master plan process, was added for boaters,
specifically motorized boaters, and also to accommodate people that are fishing. And we did this, this was by design, because we knew as soon as we opened this park, there would be a very high demand for motorized boats to come into this park to either hang out, to offload, to use the restrooms. So this is how the park was designed and is intended to operate. What we didn't do last year was we didn't put this language into our code. And we ended up with some enforcement issues. So we worked with King County Marine Patrol and our own police officers, and they said, look, you need to take what you're doing operationally and put it into code. So going back to, this is a picture of the North Dock in action last summer. So you can see it's doing what it's supposed to do, and this is not an area that would be safe for swimming. So we will, upon adoption of our ordinance in a few weeks, we will actually sign this dock, no swimming.
Okay. Councilmember Jarrett.
Bessie, how far out from the shoreline does the dock go? Because certainly you can swim in Lake Sammamish beyond the swimming dock outside the buoys. But where is it permitted and where isn't it permitted? Pine Lake Park also.
I'm up quite a bit. And Carrie can help me with this answer. When you access the waters via our park and you're swimming adjacent to our park, you are restricted to that area. I just showed you area of Sammamish Landing that you're expressly permitted to swim. I think our carrier regulations go out as a city to the center of the lake.
Actually, the city incorporated by reference provisions of King County's code when the city incorporated back in 1999. And already part of our code that's already adopted and been in place since 1999 is a provision of King County code adopted in our Sammamish Municipal Code Chapter 12.05, and it's 12.44.210 regarding swimming. And it says that swimming is confined to restricted swimming areas or within a distance of 50 feet from the shore or a pier, unless the swimmer is accompanied by a watercraft. And that's actually the regulation in existence today and has been since 99.
So when we incorporated gas-powered engines were allowed on Pine Lake, now it's only electric and the 7 mile speed limit. What you're saying is someone cannot swim across that lake, like former council member Curley, without being accompanied by a watercraft. Is that what you're saying?
Well, that is what this says, but again, I think that certain watercraft have been prohibited on Beaver Lake, and I'm not sure what the Pine Lake that you were specifically asking about.
Electric motors only.
Electric motors only.
But there really isn't a danger to a swimmer.
Because there's no propeller.
There is a propeller.
Well, I mean, there's a propeller, but there's no... Is there a danger to the swimmer? I feel like there perhaps is if the boater's not exercising reasonable care and caution, which our regulations also talk about rules of the road is what they're known as for boats even. And so they're supposed to exercise ordinary care and prudence to avoid conflicts with swimmers. That's also in our existing regulations.
Councilmember O'Dell.
For the benefit of everyone, I own a electric outboard. And believe me, I would not want to stick my finger into it when it's running. So, yeah, there could be a danger, particularly to legs and arms. Just out of curiosity, do the park boundaries extend to the city limit, which is the middle of the lake? Do I have an opinion on that?
That is not specified in our code. Where our jurisdiction extends to, at least it's not in these chapters that you're being asked to look at that we are recommending certain amendments to. It may be elsewhere in the city code, I'm not sure. But I believe in other contexts it's specified that it's the middle of the lake, but it's not in either chapter 12.05 or 7.12. It could be in another part of the Sammamish Municipal Code.
We need to stick to the to the things that are being changed on this resolution.
Things I'll just add, again, this came from a lengthy discussion of the Parks Commission at our park system. One of our greatest areas of risk is our beaches, and we have a duty to provide safe access for, and especially at Sammamish Landing, where it's particularly challenging for a variety of users. Our
ordinance, they're not intended to take away the fun, but they're intended to designate a swimming area and say, this is a safe place to swim. When people choose to do otherwise, we have some protections as a city because we have said, this is where you swim, this is where you don't swim, this is where you boat, and this is where you don't boat. So it is very black and white by design, and that's for risk management and safety reasons. Now, that doesn't mean people always follow the rules.
Councilmember Whitten, you had a question?
Well, when you're regulating, though, I think the enforceability is the uniformity of regulations with other jurisdictions is important for enforcement purposes. If we like want to call in the King County Sheriff, so I think it's probably something over time you should become familiar with. And what you can do in these areas, of course, has to do with the fact that Lake Sammamish is a navigable lake. And do these properties have second-class shorelands from the state? And I mean, that would have go back to ownership cities. So there are complex issues in there. You may get a different result for one purpose than for another. But the swimming ones, the drunk boating ones, all those kinds of things should be regulated under a county regulation if we're going to reuse their marine resources to do this.
That's an excellent point, Councilmember Whitten. As part of our research in creating these amendments, we looked at the other jurisdictions surrounding Lake Sammamish. As we all know, it's Bellevue, Issaquah, and Redmond as well. And we looked at that consistency piece to see if we are in line and consistent with the regulations of these neighboring jurisdictions surrounding Lake Sammamish in particular. And for example, I think today Councilmember Jaron raised the question about the proposed requirement for boaters to maintain a distance of 50 feet from swimmers, and this sort of dovetails on what we were talking about just a second ago. I double checked, and I had looked at this initially, but Redmond's municipal code has the same requirement, and that's in RMC 14.16.120 sub 2. It's almost verbatim languages as what we're proposing in these amendments. Also, Issaquah has the same 50-foot restriction between boaters and swimmers, again, just for safety, public safety purposes, to eliminate or try to avoid as much as possible conflicts between boaters and swimmers. However, I wanted to point out that Bellevue has protective code language, but they do not have the specific 50-feet restriction that Issaquah, Redmond, and what we're proposing Sammamish has, and I wanted to bring this to your attention. The Bellevue City Code has a protective, again, not specific 50-foot requirement that says, all watercraft shall be operated in a careful and prudent manner and shall remain at all times at a reasonable and prudent distance from the person and property of others. So that's how Bellevue did it. It's not a strict 50 feet, but I just wanted to bring that to your attention because that's another possibility if you prefer that language.
From a boat,
yes, a watercraft.
But I mean, from anybody swimming anywhere.
Well, there's exceptions for water skiing and other activities that require a watercraft in order to engage in those activities. But the intent is that a watercraft, especially a motorized one, not engage its propeller within 50 feet of a swimmer or other non-motorized craft.
Okay, let's move to the next
slide. I just want to clarify, Issaquah and Redmond don't have small lakes with electric only. So that's why I brought up the 50 feet. I can see in Lake Sammamish the logic of that because the danger is from a high-speed boat. But in Pine Lake or Beaver Lake, when you're going 1 or 2 miles an hour, I think the 50 feet is not really critical.
We could carve out an exception for Pine Lake if that would be the council's preference.
I think the language that Bellevue has would cover that sort of thing reasonably.
Again, we'll just defer to the preference of the council.
That slide's coming up, so.
There's also a difference that the state Supreme Court that held that Pine Lake wasn't navigable and therefore it was privately owned. The right to use the waters and come up by the owners around the lake, which would include the and that has a big difference in terms of
regulated, but.
One final question, Mr. We are allowing boats to tie up at the southern dock on the southern side of the creek.
And that's actually a different regulation that's coming up in just a minute.
Yeah, let's continue on. I'm waiting for running afoul of the 50-foot rule there.
Motion to address that. Okay, I'm now on page 3 of the table, item number 18. So we have some amended language here. We had lots of fun with this one at the Parks Commission. So we have some language that basically says if you're inside a big floaty duck at Pine Lake Park, we don't want you to go outside the swimming area with your floaty duck. And the reason is because you may not be able to swim. This is pretty standard language. I know you're thinking, why are you regulating flotation devices in swimming areas? This is standard language. It's aquatics safety 101 that we're saying you need to stay here. If you're floating on a flotation device, you need to stay in your swimming area. We just clarified that language because it quite right. We also expressly prohibit now non-motorized watercraft in swimming areas and also toy motorized boats. And what I want to just remind you, the reason for this is because we were having swimmer conflict with people inside swimming areas. This is inside swimming areas where these restrictions apply. You have two in your park system, one at Pine Lake and one at Sammamish Landing.
Okay. Let's go.
Okay. Well, I have a question for you on Pine Lake. What if I want to swim over park from my dock on the lake? Floating device. You didn't enter the lake from our swimming area. You entered private property, so I can swim outside there and go,
Can't land in the water. Sure.
maybe on your toy motorized device.
All right. All right. Okay. Let's continue on.
Page 3, item number 19, and Carrie's already introduced this. This is a new language in our park rules that basically mirrors the regulations we're proposing under the boating section that says you have to remain 50 feet away from a swimmer or a non-motorized watercraft. And it sounds like there was perhaps a desire to amend that language to allow for a little more flexibility on Pine Lake Park. Is that or Pine Lake?
Not Pine Lake and Beaver Lake.
Pine Lake and Beaver Lake.
All right. Is that a consensus?
I think it probably is. Okay.
Have to coordinate it with the Pine Lake has only electric motors, no other non-motorized. Is Beaver Lake the same?
I think so. It is.
Yeah. What I should have teed up as well is these regulations existed already in our code and applied only to Beaver Lake and Pine Lake. What we found when we were doing our code research is that it didn't apply, if I'm correct, to Lake Sammamish.
Because it's a navigable waterway.
All right.
Okay, so I would really appreciate some clarification from the council if you want us to revise this proposed amendment to either create an exception for Pine Lake and Beaver Lake or instead eliminate the 50-foot language and use the language, for example, that was in the Bellevue City Code. In lieu of the 50-foot.
For all lakes.
Councilmember Jern?
Well, since we have a 7-mile common border, unguarded border with Bellevue.
Unguarded? Undefended.
Are you sure? We've got those dogs.
It would make sense, perhaps, to have the same regulation as Bellevue. I would support that.
Yeah, Councilmember Wooten?
I think an important actual issue to resolve is who's going to enforce that. My understanding is, I don't know who Bellevue uses, but we use King County resources, marine resources. And I think they need one common definition. And I think the 50 feet, there have been close calls that's come up several times over the many years in Lake Sammamish that there's some safety concerns when motorboats, in fact, when they go too close to the shoreline and people are recreating. So I think you need the 50 feet to present clarity so people can be informed.
Does Bellevue have their own marine patrol in Lake Sammamish?
I think you need to find that out, though, is how it would have been.
I think the county patrols them.
I will share, the enforcement at Lake Sammamish this last summer was done, in water enforcement was done largely by King County Marine Patrol. Through regular patrols of our beach, landward enforcement was done by our own Sammamish Police Department.
Our police contract includes provisions for the Marine Patrol.
Well, I mean, it would be hard on the Marine Patrol to figure out exactly where the middle of the lake is and know whether they're using Bellevue regulations or Sammamish regulations.
But we're not dealing with the whole lake here, are we?
Oh, this is lake.
Let's.
Sorry, this section is your park regulation, but I will share with you, we've added this into your boating regulations as well, which applies to the entire section of Lake Sammamish that falls within the cities.
I would prefer to keep these with me.
I think it's important to have something measurable on Lake Sammamish. And that's where it's more dangerous.
I would agree with that.
I would too.
Okay, so we'll.
Why don't we work towards that and we can deliberate on it next week or next month?
Can you check with the county about patrols on Lake Sammamish?
Okay, let's move to the next topic.
All right. This is page 4, item number 20. This just talks about where you can dock or operate a boat or motorized watercraft. What I want to point out, very bottom, we took out the section. Our code previously said you can't operate your boat within 100 feet of any city parks, lifeguard, and beach or dock during the months of June, July, August, and September. That language no longer works for us because we have Sammamish Landing where we do allow boats to land at docks. So we. But this amended language pretty much says that it will be signed. You will know where you are permitted to have a boat on a dock or a swim line and where you are not. So we will need to update our signage accordingly. Page 4 of your matrix, item number 23. This is Minister Choisimore. Pictures here. This is where we clarify that the new language we've added identifies where you can dock at Sammamish Landing. So it specifically permits you to dock on the south side of the south dock and on either side of the north dock. So the graphic again, I have some pictures too. Boats are permitted here on this side of the south dock and on either side of the north dock. So you already saw this picture. This is the south dock at Sammamish Landing. So keep in mind, this is your swimming area. We do not want boats in there, but you can see outside, that's permitted. Again, this park was designed with this intent. We just didn't have the language in our code.
Okay, no questions. Earlier, council member, or deputy mayor.
Observation, last year there were several boats that would dock on that south side. There are a lot of little children kind of bouncing and jumping up and down.
Boats. I'll tell you, we've heard loudly from the boating community. Better dock for the swimmers. Trying to reach a happy medium here.
Yes, it was the length of that dock from the shore to the
I believe it's 120.
They can get what, about 3 or 4 boats that are tied right up next to it.
What I will share is, you know, when we designed these docks, the pilings are on the outside because I didn't want the pilings in the swim area where you can have finger pinch points for swimming. But tying up a boat pilings is not really convenient. Boaters prefer not to tie up there. Boaters are upset with us because they said the pilings are on the wrong side of the dock, but for swimming, they're on the right side of the dock. So, just so you know, you have to have a pretty small boat to fit into that space without banging against those.
Lots of bumpers. Okay. Councilmember Kelly?
It's like there's a ladder.
Yeah.
Water right
That's those are rescue ladders that are required in case we have an emergency rescue from the waterward side. We worked with King County Marine Patrol to get those installed. I know it's counterintuitive. It encourages swimming, but they're actually there for rescue.
Next.
Okay. All right. Now this is the same language we just saw, but this is in the boating regulations section. So this is where we talked about the 50 feet restriction. So we've got it both places in your park code and also in your boating regulations. I'm going to assume that we'll make the same changes here on the.
I think so.
This is a new section of your boating code, and I'll just note that when we did our research and looked at what other jurisdictions were doing, all of our neighbors have restrictions on noise, muffled engines on the lakes, and we did not have anything in our code, so our Parks Commission recommended that we add something that basically says you have to have a muffler or silencer boat operation.
Okay, Councilmember Wynn.
Does this apply to like jet skis and I assume that the ski planes are governed by this because of the definition section that excluded them. But what about jet skis and other things? Some of them have quite a roar.
I understand those, believe it or not, are actually muffled. The boats, and I'm sure you've heard of them, that aren't muffled are pretty distinct. This would bring our code in line with other folks.
This is any engine, so it would include ski boats, but they do have to be muffled. That's what we're saying. Everything. Okay. Next.
Right. That actually concludes our swimming and boating section. This is a little housekeeping matter under the responsibility section in our parks code. Basically, the section said the parks director and the police chief can work together to provide supplementary patrols. We actually decided to give the city manager some authority here. I know.
I'll regret later.
So housekeeping item.
Police baton.
I'm sure Ben would love to go out and do park patrols, right?
I'm sure he would.
We also are repealing an entire section on contractual agreements. It's redundant. It says we can execute contracts for enforcement, and it basically says the same thing the previous section does, just in a different way.
All right, next.
All right, this is one where I'm sure you may want to chat with Commissioner Klein. We have included a complete prohibition on tobacco and related products in our ordinance. Your Parks Commission has been working on the Tobacco Free Parks Initiative for almost 3 years now. It was previously brought to council via a policy, and there was quite a discussion a couple years ago. At that time, you charged us with working on this and bringing it back, and it took a little time to get it back to you. That is your muse.
Okay, Councilmember Mulgrew.
Yeah, I went through and I found it interesting that we do have listed cigars, cigarettes, tobaccos, chewing gums, and the like, and electric cigarettes, but the one I didn't notice was marijuana. So will that be covered here, or is that kind of different? Because we have alcoholic beverages in another section, but I did not see the narcotics.
That's because, Councilmember Valderrama, the state law already covers that and prohibits the open smoking of marijuana, even recreationally, works. So that's already covered by state law. And so we didn't feel the need to add.
Would it be duplicative to have it here? Is that the case? Or would it be clearer by making sure the residents know that the ordinance has it?
Felt that it was already sufficiently regulated at the state level. That's why we didn't include that here. It's my understanding, again, that that's not allowed at a place like a public park. So I can double check that for you, but I did research that initially because this was intended to focus on, again, our public parks. And so it's my understanding that's already prohibited our public parks.
That's more Jared.
I have to confess that I've never seen a vapor electric cigarette, but I'm wondering what the discussion was about that. And with those.
I've only seen them in passing myself. I'm not aware of any adverse effect from smoke or steam or anything like that on adjacent people. However, we felt that we have a significant youth population in our city, and the appearance is that someone is smoking. It's difficult for especially a young person to distinguish the difference between smoking a tobacco cigarette versus an electric cigarette. And what we're trying to do is discourage the use of cigarettes in a public facility to ensure that that they're seen as the parks are seen as a healthy place for all to enjoy. So we thought it would be difficult to allow that, better to all encompass the regulation.
This has been pretty consistently the position of the Parks Commission over the last
it has
few
been
years.
For, yeah, since we initially brought it up 3 years ago.
Any other questions?
I'm with it.
Councilmember Kelly?
Place that alcohol is allowed in your park system routinely by the Beaver Lake Lodge. Alcohol is allowed in other areas of the park system by permit of the parks director only.
Sure.
Sorry. So what I was just saying is Beaver Lake Lodge is the only place in your park system where we routinely allow alcohol, and that's associated with private rentals. Other areas of your park system, alcohol is allowed by permit of the parks director. Since I have been here, I have only issued one permit for outdoor alcohol consumption, and that is for Sammamish nights. We do not allow, generally, alcohol in any part of your park, really ever, unless it's a special event.
Councilmember Whitten?
We allow guns in parks.
I think that's covered by state law as well.
So, I guess my concern about this is it came up to us 2 or 3 years ago, and I thought the council had tabled it. I didn't think it was being pursued. There was a lot of thought as to a ban and the scope of a ban. And I understand there are, this is a complete ban, and it would mean that no matter where you are in the parks, no matter who's not there or not there around you, you can't smoke in a park. I understand that there are good reasons for it. There are good reasons for a plastic bag ban. There are good reasons for being Big Brother and saying you can't skate park without a helmet. But we don't do that. Where do we draw the line? I mean, I fully support a ban of tobacco where kids congregate, where there are people around, at boating areas, at playgrounds, on the athletic fields, in stadiums, and viewing things. But I think this is just too broad. I think it's Big Brother. I know other jurisdictions have struggled with this, and some have adopted a complete ban, and some have taken a more reasonable approach and saying, what's the problem you're trying to fix? Identify it, and then scope your ban appropriate to that. So, I mean, you know, I'm married to a doctor. I have a daughter who's a doctor. My father was a doctor. They were all adamantly opposed to smoking. I'm very aware of the dangers of smoking. But I do think smokers have rights. And I think just taking a blunt instrument and hitting them all on the head with it is probably overreaching. So I think there's a solution that would take a more moderate approach, which would restrict it where there are going to be people, you know, and not just say our preserve, Evans Creek Preserve. That would mean nobody could smoke anything there, correct? I mean, and maybe you don't want them to. But I think this is too broad, and I really think we're in danger of being Big Brother.
First, City Manager, do you want to interject?
Thank you. This is... it's a very common regulation in all parks on the east side. We're trying to be consistent, I think, with what the other parks are doing in the region. And we have heard some complaints, particularly during the summer events, when people are all together and then there's somebody smoking a cigarette and then the it actually bothers the others around that person. So, yes, it is brought, but, you know, frankly, park is not a place to smoke a cigarette.
No, but we can do it in the sidewalk leading up to the park.
Well, that's a different issue. Deputy Mayor Huckabee, and then I'll jump in.
Yes, from my perspective, it's a maintenance issue at the park level. Again, I'll go back to my experience as a Kiwanian, and we pick up along the roadway, and by and large, half the bag is filled with cigarette butts that are thrown out of cars or people that are driving by. And just this morning, I was having coffee with some friends over at Starbucks, and there's a lady that lives just two houses outside of the park. And she was complaining about the amount of trash and things that's dumped along that. I think it's Southeast 226 there that ends as a cul-de-sac in the park. And she was even suggesting that we might want to put a trash can outside the park, either maybe just on concert nights or on other times. But that neighborhood is very concerned about all the trash, the cigarette butts, and the other things that they're seeing when people go home from the park system.
Yeah, I guess I have to disagree with Councilmember Whitman on trying to regulate it in certain areas where people are, because I like those parts of the park where people aren't a lot of the times, and walking down a pristine trail in Beaver Lake Preserve or one of the other preserves or Future and Big Rock Park. I mean, the last thing, you know, I'm going there for a little fresh air and some, and to see trees and the woods, and the last thing I want to take a whiff of is somebody's cigarette, even if they're not even within sight, or see the butts along the trail. So I'm in support of this, and under no circumstances, I'm absolutely in support of this, adding this.
I think it's also important to note that the state has regulated smoking on school campuses, any school grounds. So if it's overreaching, it's certainly not overreaching for the city of Sammamish to consider this regulation, because the state has done that on an even much greater level.
Okay. Any other thoughts?
Councilman, my last thought is there, you haven't called out, but I would suggest, given the prevalence of hookahs now across our school systems, that we probably want to have that specifically cited.
Would that be regulated under state law?
Hookahs? I don't know if there would be any more than the vapor electric cigarettes.
I'll have to look into that, and we can add language if that's appropriate.
I would look at what language might be added, if necessary.
I think if we're going to do this, we should take a much broader approach, and let's eliminate smoking in the city, period. Let's eliminate it in apartments and homes and on sidewalks.
Thank you.
Okay, we'll take
Council it up. Councilmember
Garand. I wanted to thank Hank and the rest of the Parks Commission for doing a lot of work on this. I know it sounds like we're a little picky, but for the most part, we appreciate all the work you've
Absolutely.
Done.
Absolutely. Okay.
And the good news is, that was your last slide.
That was it. Okay, well, there we go.
Oh, yeah.
We will be bringing this back first week of May, I believe.
Yes.
Should I offer some public comment? Does anyone like to give public comment on this one?
I would like to ask that you bring back and show us the other regulations other than just a complete ban.
Okay. A research project.
Yeah, well, we already have it because we had it from 3 years ago.
Not seeing anyone else who would like to give public comment. I guess we're not going to have any. So we're done with this issue until the first meeting in May, I believe.
Can we have the other options available then?
Is that a consensus?
Yes. I'll have to go look at them.
Yeah. The other options meaning?
Doing research on other regulations. Or something. Presumably you've already done that, I guess.
We've already done that.
Well, you know what the other parks doing in the region, right? Yeah. So I think council member with him would like to see what.
Are you specifically regarding about
cigarette smoking and all the other stuff? Okay. That's what she's asking.
Designated areas, is that it?
I don't want the staff to take a lot of time, but if there is a draft regulation that is easily available that was discussed before.
I think we did that research last go around, so we should have that readily available.
Right.
Okay.
I'd also like to, if we're going to go this route, I'd also like to include the marijuana question. How are other parks dealing with it?
Good question. Let's have our legal counsel to check into that one later.
I'll check into hookah and marijuana.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And drug paraphernalia. I think the hookahs.
That's correct. They use it also for marijuana. That's
all right.
The problem.
Let's we have all our questions out. So let's move on to item number 8, a resolution supporting the Central Issaquah Plan, supporting the designation of Issaquah as an urban center by the King County Growth Management Planning Council, and supporting the designation of Issaquah as a regional growth center by the Puget Sound Regional Council. This would be R-2014-579. Mr. City Manager.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of the council. Before you are two resolutions. One is resolution is council support for the City of Issaquah's Central Issaquah Plan and designating Issaquah as an urban center and regional growth center. Second one is relating to the interlocal agreement that we currently discuss and negotiated with City of Issaquah. We had an extensive discussion at the study session about a week ago. We went through item by items what's in the interlocal agreement. Tonight, what I'm asking you to pass the resolution to authorize me to sign this legal document. So in essence, I'm having these both items together, Mr. Mayor, item number 8 and 9, starting with the 9 perhaps, because the both of them are interrelated to each other. Item number 9 is related to Klahani PAA interlocal agreement. This was a council's direction right at, after the retreat, or right at the retreat. If the Klahani annexation fails, you wanted us to discuss with the City of Issaquah to find the terms, come to current terms with them to make sure that the Issaquah's PAA is amended in 2014, and then that this particular PAA planning and annexation area is put into City of Sammamish's planning and annexation area. Election was in February. Although City of Issaquah was seeking 60% approval at that election, it was below 50%. So Klahani residents did not approve that particular annexation. Since then, we've been having discussions with City of Issaquah representatives, mayor's office, administration office, council presidents, and council members. We've been working, three of us, mayor, deputy mayor, and myself, on this. It was a good team effort, and I think along the way we contacted almost all of you before the final agreement, final draft was presented to you last week. So let me go through the terms of this agreement.
Are we doing 9 first and then
8? Mr. Mayor.
Okay.
As a point of order, shouldn't we do it in the order it was presented, and also because it is a subset of this?
Well, the problem is that the 9 is the big one, so I should have put the 9 in the agenda before you.
The 9 calls for us to do 8, so we should do 9 and then do 8.
Right.
8 and then look at the big one that includes it?
No, because 9 calls for us to do 8.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. So, the council member Valderrama, it's my mistake. I should have put the item number 9 in the order first. Okay. That should have been the 8, and 8 should have been 9, because this 9 requires us to adopt the resolution.
Just to be clear, item 9 is a resolution authorizing the execution of an interlocal agreement with the City of Issaquah regarding the Klahani potential annexation area, and this, if approved, would be R-2014-580.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. The good news, we reached an agreement with City of Issaquah, and the terms of the agreements are we both agreed to amend the PAAs for Klahani, take it out of the Issaquah's PAA and put it in the City of Sammamish's planning annexation area. Issaquah agreed to do that amendment by the end of 2014. They also agreed to have a joint petition with us and work with us before appropriate governmental entities, particularly Growth Management Policy Council, King County Council, and also that the Boundary Review Board. And we both agree to join the forces in case if any legal challenges is filed for either city. What we in turn agree to do, we as City of Sammamish, we agree to support for Issaquah's Central Area Plan. We agree to support Issaquah's Urban Center and Regional Growth Center designations. We agree to not impose or accept the state's retail sales tax credit for Klahani annexation. We also agreed to reimburse City of Issaquah $30,000 for the annexation study that they did for the Klahani area. We think that we can benefit from that study, and they spent close to $100,000. We're reimbursing them about $30,000. Lastly, Issaquah Falls City Road. Within 6 months of annexation, Issaquah and Sammamish will jointly agree on the scope and timing of the Issaquah Falls City Road project. This is an important project for us, particularly for the eastern part of our city, Trosek, Alderaan, Montane folks. This is a main corridor for them to get on and off the I-90, the interstate I-90 corridor. More specifically, within 1 year of annexation, we agreed to allocate $3 million for this particular road project. We agreed to add Issaquah Falls City Road as one of the city's top four priority projects. We agreed to complete preliminary engineering and detailed cost estimate. We both, Sammamish and Issaquah, agreed to pursue state and federal matching funds to complete the improvements. Issaquah's role, obviously, and at that, on this particular item is to support the city with the letter of support or helping us to lobby with some of those grant funds. We think what we agreed to do is what we had verbally agreed to before the election. These are the commitments that we made. The commitments we made, we put in the writing. And when we make those commitments, we knowingly make those commitments. And we can make those commitments. And we're just simply honoring those commitments. The road project is a critical project that we need to do. We agreed to not to take the sales tax assistance from the state. And we agreed to make this a top priority project because it's not only important for Klahani, it's important for our city residents as well. This is a good agreement. Completed this agreement, in my opinion, light speed, within about 7 weeks of election. Reason we move fast on this, trying to get this agreement before the Growth Management Policy Council. That is the next meeting on the 21st of May. Councilmember Odell sits on that committee, and the staff requested us to get the information 2 weeks in advance of the meeting. That brings us to about May 7th. Frankly, this is the only last council meeting, except the May 6th meeting, but the May 6th doesn't give us much of time. I mean, we're not going to get out of the council meeting and the both cities join to work together to get the letter and all the other stuff and submit to the Growth Management Policy Council. I strongly recommend your favorable consideration of approving this resolution to giving me the authority to sign this interlocal agreement.
Okay, before we do discussion, I'd like to go ahead and get a motion to move to approve the resolution authorizing. Well,
questions.
Okay, if we keep it to questions. Councilmember Rodas.
I was first.
Let's go with Deputy Mayor Huckabee and then
I wanted to make the motion.
Oh, okay. Too late. You wanted to make the motion. Okay.
Hold on.
I am definitely going to be supporting this, but
that's
just
not a question. We need
no.
Keep
I'm finishing
questions.
My question. Okay. But my question is, we know that have we heard anything from Issaquah that would indicate that they would not want to agree to this agreement?
No, as a matter of fact, contrary. What we heard from City of Issaquah, they had their study session. What I also talked to the mayors directly, they are adopting the particular interlocal agreement without any changes. And I think that it's tonight that they're discussing it about the same time.
They did a study session last session.
But they have a committee.
Committee report, and it's coming to the council next week.
Any other questions? Councilmember Valderrama.
Yeah, I go back to the question on the annexation study. The other points, as you mentioned, were cited before. And again, I would like to thank everybody for having gotten this done so expeditiously, but the annexation study was not something that we had talked about before. About a month ago, as I recall, the city had come to the council and asked for approximately $50,000, or looking at about $50,000 to do a new study on the PAA area.
at that point. So where they were even talking about taking the same firm that had done the Issaquah study to do it for $50,000. At that time, there was some resistance from council members, including myself, who asked, well, if we have a public document and we're looking at the same area and we're looking at the same police, fire, water services, we're really not changing much here other than the water. Now we're talking about this $30,000 for Issaquah, where they will give us the document that's a public document at this point, but some background information. And I just want to clarify, so if we're going to pay $30,000 to Issaquah, would that then reduce that $50,000 to $20,000? Because the original study cost $100,000. So I'd like some clarification on that.
I know you asked that question last time also, Councilmember Valderrama. And I don't have a good answer for you because I don't have the specific proposals in front of me. We discussed this item at the retreat, sir. This was discussed amongst all of us. So this is not an item that we have not discussed. It was this a was topic. Not, we spent time on this thing. If I may finish.
Discussion.
If I may finish.
Yes, we have.
Yes.
And Don specifically said, well, maybe we could give Issaquah $30,000 to $50,000 for their study.
The retreat had said it, but then how that fits with the $50,000.
Yeah, and then let me get to that one. Issaquah spent $100,000 on the study. There are components of the study would be very helpful to us. We still have to do our own work. The particular components that I'm talking right now, without spending much of time on the scope of the work, impacts of this annexation to King County. That's done. So we know that, what the impacts. Now we need to make some adjustments to that one because the financial impact to King County would be a little bit different if this area to annex the city of Sammamish. How so? We do have some contracting work that we do with the King County. For example, police services. We would be hiring some additional police officers that would have some positive impacts on that one. Assessment of the existing infrastructure, that will be helpful to us. What we don't know is that precisely what the boundary review board would ask us, even though we did some thumb sketch estimates or very rough estimates previously, what are the revenue sources, what other expenses that we're going to incur from the public works, general government, planning, legal, all those areas that we have to go through it. So it would benefit us, we would benefit from it immensely, especially if we get the background documents and the digital versions of these things. But we still have to do additional work as we had previously thought we would need to do. That hasn't changed. We still have to identify Sammamish's impacts. What's the impact of Sammamish and what is that impact financially in different areas of the government services that we provide? I can't give you numbers right now. You ask me that. I don't anticipate that number is going to be less than that. But that, let me work on that one. That's not what we're trying to address tonight.
Okay. All right. As long as we're working, there is some saving, or else why are we paying the $30,000?
Well, again, we discussed this at the retreat extensively, sir.
I guess on a rational level, if we were going to pay them, it was to save on our study.
And it will save us money.
That's where I'm going towards, is will it save? Because we were originally saying without that, $50,000. And if now we're saying it's 50 plus 30, which is 80.
And if I give you the number right now, you're going to tell me next week this is the number that you said, Mr. City Manager. And I'm telling you, sir, I don't have the numbers.
All right, as long as we don't come close to the original.
And I'm not going to give you the numbers tonight.
Any other questions? Councilmember Jared?
Mr. City Manager, would you say that if there wasn't any study done by Issaquah, it would probably cost $100,000 for us to do the study because that's what it cost Issaquah to do the study.
And that was a couple of years ago. They signed a contract, so one would assume that would probably inflationary cost and the rate adjustments the consultants do almost every year. I would suspect $110,000 to $115,000, Councilmember Chair.
But we'll get that number
right
down the road. Okay, any other questions? So now can I have a motion to approve the resolution authorizing the city manager to execute an interlocal agreement with the city of Issaquah regarding the Kalani potential annexation area. Councilmember O'Dowd.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'd like to move to approve the resolution authorizing the city manager to execute an interlocal agreement with the city of Issaquah regarding the Klahani potential annexation area.
Second.
Thank you. Thank you for repeating that.
It's an important resolution.
Absolutely. We should have that, everybody, this clarity.
May I speak to my motion?
Please.
Yeah. Thank you. I'm happy to do this. Very happy to do this. It's been a long road. Early last fall, that's about when we started this process. There was a boundary review board hearing for Klahani's annexation by Issaquah. It was attended by Councilmember Jarrett, Councilmember Valderrama, and myself, at which we urged that the residents of Klahani be given an option of Sammamish or Issaquah, not just up or down on Issaquah. That did not happen. The Boundary Review Board went ahead and let Issaquah run the election as they had proposed, which was their right to do, frankly. However, I think the fact that members of this city council came forth with, I think, a pretty good case for thinking about Sammamish in addition to Issaquah resulted in the outcome of the election that we're looking at today. I'm pleased that our counterparts at Issaquah, I've been working so well with members of this administration and this city council and the Issaquah administration as well, to bring about a situation where we can go forward to the Growth Management Policy Committee at King County with a joint plan. If we were not able to do so, the losers would be the residents of Klahani, because the whole process would be dragged out much longer. This is the best way to expedite this process, and I'm very thankful to the members who of both councils and both administrations who worked on this to come up with this agreement. I am fully supportive of it, and I will be very supportive of it as your representative to the GMPC.
Anybody else from that side? Councilmember Keller?
I'd like to say that I want to thank our leadership for negotiating with the city of Issaquah. This looks like we're entering into a new era with Issaquah. To be honest with you, it was very nice that they came to our meeting last week and actually presented their city plan to us. I think what working together with them will actually jointly improve the roads right away. To be brief, we're going to be working on the internal roads, Issaquah Pine Lake Road, and they're going to be working on the last part of Sammamish by 90. And so, really, both cities are going to be winning. I appreciate the fact that they came and did that. I look forward to this. And also appreciate the fact that they're going to add to their agenda processing of this.
Thank you. I think this is a culmination of 15 years of trying to do what, by looking at a map, is the logical, correct thing to do. I give credit to the Boundary Review Board. By state law, they were simply required to determine whether or not Issaquah could provide adequate services to Klahani, and they concluded that, yes, Issaquah could. They weren't asked or allowed to really make a decision whether or not Sammamish could provide services more efficiently because of the geographic obvious facts. And so they didn't make that determination. So now going forward, when we get back to the Boundary Review Board, I don't think there will be any question that clearly the logical place for Klahani to have annexed in the first place. So I'm really excited.
Yes, this is a culmination, you're right, of a long road, and it's actually about a 20-year road. When we started our first incorporation attempt, we were hopeful that Klahani would join us because it seemed do see that this also gives us a real opportunity to some of the issues that we have to deal with. For example, I-90 and perhaps going after federal money, because we are all paying a huge price for the fact that I-90 does not work well for our communities.
There are many other things that we can work jointly together with, so I'm very excited about that opportunity.
Councilmember Alderama?
Again, I praise the speed of which you had gotten this expedited to come to us. However, this is really about trying to do what's best for the citizens of Klahani and also what's best for the citizens of Sammamish. That's the bottom line. I wish that this language had come to us so we could have reviewed it and been able to fix some of this language. Even this morning, I spoke with Rob Young, who is responsible for, had been in favor of the annexation for Issaquah for Klahani, who's very supportive to come in. And his question is, why is the urban center designation even in this? What does that have to do? Nonetheless, because it's allowing us to have new levels of cooperation and doing something that's right, I would be supportive. I just wish that we could have had the chance to look at this as a council, to be able to look at the language. There's duplicative languages in, as in Sammamish agrees to support and not oppose. That seems redundant. I've had citizens from Sammamish ask me about the language on the retail sales tax credit. I much preferred the language that Councilmember Jaron had put in, that after our evaluations and looking at that we can provide these services better, that we had made the comments that Tom O'Dell had mentioned to the Boundary Review Board that we would not be seeking or looking for the retail tax credit. So I am very supportive of the agreement, supportive of working with Issaquah to get this expedited for those citizens of Klahani and for the citizens of Sammamish. But I'm disappointed that we had not been able, both councils, to look at this previously.
Councilmember Whitten.
I'm going to echo Romero's thoughts. I think this is a great process, a great step to get improve our relationship with Issaquah and work constructively. I think that's really important. And I think Klahani fits with our city. I've always said I would support it, but I never wanted to be seen as imposing ourselves on Klahani. So I think the fact that they've gone through the vote for Issaquah and now they'll have another opportunity to have a vote whether or not to join Sammamish is a great thing. So I'm very pleased. I'm very pleased the negotiations brought in the entirety of the planning area and that it wasn't bifurcated. I think that was a concern, and I think this is a really excellent result. I do have concern about the inclusion of the central plan in it, but that's not going to support me from my stop me from supporting it. I do have a concern about the process by which this has arrived at. I don't think our best government is when we all have an equal opportunity to participate in our decision making. And frankly, this came to us because of the team effort by two of our council persons and staff. It came to us as a take it or leave it, as I understand it. We're not even permitted to ask for simple word changes. So I think we get a better result when we have time to negotiate this and have input from all council members. I really don't like being put in the position of taking it or leaving it and having it negotiated by two and not being kept.
For the record, I want to just clarify a couple of things.
Yes, please, Mr. City Manager.
Incorrect. There's nothing about fire study in this agreement. There's nothing about water sewer district. Thanks to some of your input during the negotiations of this agreement, you have made some inputs and we took it out.
there was no implications or indication from City of Issaquah that we do take over the water sewer district. So I don't want any misconception, because these are very dangerous.
Completely separate issues and not related to the ILA.
Oh.
I want to, you know, there were a lot of meetings. I really want to thank Mayor Fred Butler and Council President Paul Winterstein for meeting with me and other council members, for meeting with Deputy Mayor Huckabee. Important meetings that did a lot to prepare the way for this agreement. I do also want to acknowledge a lot of the hard work, the day-to-day hard work between Mayor Butler was with our city manager, Ben Yasigi, who did so much of the work on a day-to-day basis in terms of getting this ILA put together. So I really do want to acknowledge that as well. Not all these things always end up in the newspaper, but I do want to say that. I from the beginning, I have, before there was an ILA, before there was even a thought that there would be an ILA, from my point of view, this was all about changing and changing our relationship with Issaquah and making it a better one for the region, for a lot of the regional issues that we have mentioned here tonight, transportation being one of the biggest ones. So I'm very happy to support this. I kind of saw the sausage being made, if you will, but it was a long process. A lot of things came in, a lot of things went out. And I think this is the best we could possibly come up with. And keep in mind, it was a two-way street. It was Issaquah as well as Sammamish. So I will be supporting it. Okay, final words, if you will, very final words. Call a question. All in favor of supporting the resolution, say aye.
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 Any opposed? It passes unanimously.
Thank you, Council.
Now we go to resolution represented by item 8, supporting the Central Issaquah Plan, supporting the designation of Issaquah as an urban center by the King County Growth Management Planning Council, and supporting the designation of Issaquah as a regional growth center by the Puget Sound Regional Council, which would be R 2014-579. Any last questions on this issue from anyone, although we've had it before us for a few minutes now?
Wait a second, we haven't had this for a few months ago.
Well, he was talking about both, actually, so yes. But here's your opportunity if you want to ask a question.
Hold on one second.
You want me to just kind of brief reminder for Council, the background information again, Mr. Mayor?
Go ahead.
Yeah. this is part of the agreement that we just authorized. You just authorized me to sign it, and that requires us to provide a support for the Central Issaquah Plan. Plan was already developed and went through the environmental review process almost a couple of years ago. Issaquah was kind enough to send about the 4 staff members here last week in study session. We went through extensively the entire plan. We asked questions. We get some answers. I think it's time that we need to approve the resolution to extend our support for them. So I ask Council's strong consideration to approve the resolution to lend the support for Central Issaquah Plan and designates this Issaquah as urban center, and also our support for their desire to become a regional growth center in the future.
Okay. Any questions? Listen. Okay, let's. Can I have a motion to approve the resolution?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion?
Nancy, myself, with.
Well, we went the other way. Let's go this.
I don't care.
Councilmember Whitten?
I have serious. We had an excellent presentation by Issaquah staff, but again, it was an executive summary of what their plan entails. And my questions, some of them really didn't get answered in terms of the stormwater, the environmental implications of the plan, and also on traffic and transportation. I support this, though. I had a talk with one of my fellow attorneys at my firm, with Stacy Goodman today, and she pointed out that if we have reservations as a city about the Issaquah plan, this is a sub-area plan, and it can come before them every year for amendments. And they would certainly be willing to lend us this ear, and, you know, in a spirit of cooperation, to talk to us and to discuss these things. So I feel very positive that this is a new beginning with Issaquah. And if we'd gotten involved, you know, several years ago, I would have had a lot of reservations about this kind of density and so forth. But I think it's been well thought out by them, and I think for Issaquah it's probably a good fit. And in terms of the concerns for Sammamish, I think that's something that we can work on with them over time. And I think the traffic in particular will be pretty evident if their projects start getting built. So I support this. But again, this is the key problem I had with the proposal, and as it was the process as done by the quote team. And that is that we didn't have input on it. It was take it or leave it. And I, with the concerns we had, some of them have been mitigated by the disclosure or the presentation we got. But I don't think, I think there's a better way of getting even better results, and that's to include everybody at an early opportunity.
Councilmember Alderama?
Now, building on what Councilmember Witten said, first of all, I want to thank Issaquah for coming to us, giving us that presentation. They've been great. As Paul Winterstein had said, it's unprecedented cooperation that we're headed down that path, and hopefully that'll continue on all fronts. They did give us an executive summary. Information that I and others had asked for are still pending on timing of projects and that, but it's a great beginning, and I appreciate that. Following on, I assume that this is not a fait accompli, that this can have modifications to the resolution, since it's not going to be seen by the Issaquah Council. This is a Sammamish Council, in which case, since we are going to be working with Issaquah, reviewing the plan and analyzing it over the years, and following up on what Council Member Witten said and that council members from Issaquah were agreeable to, that the motion be to approve a resolution where we work with Issaquah analyzing the Issaquah Central Plan and support the Issaquah Central Plan, or some language to that effect that says that we will be doing this and getting more detail.
Mr. City Manager, do you want to address that issue?
Yeah, I don't want to put the city of Issaquah in any commitment here, even though it's a good intention of one council member is telling to one of our council members. Councilmember Valderrama, I think that would be best not to put that here as a condition of our resolution, but I follow up with the administration, and then we follow up with the council, and Mayor, Deputy Mayor and I were talking about that we need to have a joint meeting anyway, so that might be a good opportunity with the both city councils are meeting, and then they bring that up in that meeting. But not knowing where the administration is, where the rest of the council is, I would not be part of or recommending you that the
we have to take it or leave it also on this document as well.
Well, hearing, basically.
Make a motion for an amendment.
I will move for a motion then that we add the clause to approve the resolution where we work with Issaquah to analyze and support the Central Issaquah Plan.
There a second?
I cannot second that. I'm true, but I think.
Any other? There not being a second, the amendment, I guess it is, fails.
Yes, Issaquah has been on a path to create an urban center for many, many years. You know, many years ago, we had looked at annexing into Issaquah. No, frankly, knowing Fred Butler for many years, that has certainly been a goal. And one of the goals in granting that urban center is the opportunity to bring some I-90 to the east side, which would serve our communities as well. This is a 30-year plan. It's going often. I hear from Issaquah residents, some are happy with it, some are very unhappy with it. They're questioning it greatly. Frankly, I think we'll have an opportunity to talk with them about it, but I would not want to include language such as analyze, because I don't want Redmond or Issaquah or Bellevue or anybody else that happens to have any connection with our city to analyze our comprehensive plan before we approve. So I'm pleased to support this, recognizing that it's going to be a very fluid document, and looking at working with Issaquah to make sure that our traffic needs and their traffic needs are, frankly, we have so much more in common, especially with Bellevue College coming to the area, with Swedish Hospital in the area, that we have just so many more things to work together on, that I support this plan and will look forward to making comments over time on their
I want to reiterate that I was really pleased with the presentation by the Issaquah staff. They did a good job explaining a lot of the questions I had with regard to the Central Issaquah plan. And I think they adequately explicated the environmental issues, clearly showing that indeed it will improve the water quality, retrofit to a lot of the projects that are already there. I think the plan is only a 20-year plan, though, is that talking 2031 or something like that. Whereas Sound Transit 3, which is the next phase of Sound Transit plan, doesn't include light rail to Issaquah. It's somewhere in, I think they have it in their long-range strategic
plan. My grandchild's son of future.
That's right. But what the Urban Growth Center or Regional Growth Center, which is the PSRC designation, you do get more credits for federally federal grants, so there is an argument there for that helping us to get grant money for Issaquah Falls City Road improvements and potentially Issaquah Pine Lake Road improvements, because those routes would then be connections to a regional center, and we'll get some more points that way. And since we're in this agreement, or the other agreement, we already have that Issaquah is going to work with us to get that grant money. I'm pretty encouraged about that.
Councilmember.
Thank you. Well, I wish I could say I was pleased with the Issaquah Council's Issaquah's presentation of the study session, but unfortunately I wasn't here for it, and also unfortunately the stream video did not work for me that night either. I was thinking it was operator error, but after hearing we had problems again this evening, I think I'm off the hook.
Tomorrow, all AV system is going to be trash, and the new system, we're going to start building it. So
excellent. I think, I spent several hours in Pittsburgh reading this document that was produced. I spent another 8 hours on the plane reading it some more. I spent a few more hours once I got here. A lot of information in there. So you can ask a lot of questions about any part of it. You can pick apart any piece of it if you'd like. On balance, and more than on balance, it's a good document and I think a good plan. I think they address fairly adequately, or very adequately, most of the concerns I had. I too had concerns about transportation and also some of the ecological issues, particularly stormwater runoff. What I saw there was an intent to make things work. Regarding stormwater, most of the area we're talking about is already concrete or asphalt. So given the laws as exist now, that can only get better as they redevelop things. With regard to traffic, I think the fact that we've come to an agreement on the Clemente with them, and also our agreement to support this whole plan, gives us the opportunity to truly work with them on a more global basis than might otherwise be possible, for fixing issues like runoff and traffic both. The the south of the lake. They're going to come anyway, whether they have this put or not. Natural growth in the area. At least we have a plan to deal with it now. From my standpoint, I think this is key to making the southern half of the city really work from a transportation point of view. Our ability to fix Issaquah Falls City, Duthie Hill, and Issaquah Pine Lake are going to be tremendously enhanced as a result of okay with Issaquah and also the plan that they have put in front of us. Jointly, as City Manager pointed out, we will be able to go to the state legislature and the federal legislature for assistance much more effectively than we will be. So I like this plan. I look forward to supporting it. I want to commend Aaron Issaquah, Fred Butler, who I also worked with in the past on RTC and a number of other things in TP, the Transportation Partnership. I know what makes it tick. I have faith that he will do his utmost to execute this plan to the benefit not only of Issaquah, but the benefit of Sammamish as well. And I look forward to it.
I don't want to just repeat.
Okay, just to sum up, I appreciate Mayor Butler having his folks come over and talk to us. A couple of them I knew before, but a couple of them I'd never met before, so it was nice seeing them. The plan is very impressive. I know, as a couple of us have suggested in different ways, it's still taking formation, a lot of regulations, a lot of those buildings and parkways and things that will be built will have to figure out their stormwater issues with all of those parts of the Central Square Plan, and they will have to look at transportation through that area. So it's an ongoing issue, and I'm sure that hopefully we'll be kept up to date on it, and we will have some impact on what they do. So I will support it, and that being said, since we've all had a chance to talk, all in favor of the resolution, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? It passes unanimously. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Council.
Have a round of applause on behalf of all of the cities.
Oh, yeah. Sure, why not?
Thank you.
All right. To Council reports.
About the evening.
That's next. Council reports is next. I'll start it. At Councilmember Keller's end. Use your microphone, please.
Maybe comments for the deputy mayor to make. She attended as well.
And I am going to make some written comments, but at the moment, the one thing that I cannot remember was the letter that Kevin Wallace referred to that he and Claudia both signed that they were recommending that we sign. Do you remember what that, because it's coming to pick as well.
I can't name it off the top of my head, but
You'll inform us at a different.
Yes, I will. I'll follow up with that. Just a couple other comments of other things that I attended. I went to a Chamber of Commerce lunch and learn, which is something I think they're just trying to start. That is actually an interesting thing to try and help the chamber network more with the business community. So I just wanted to make note that they're still active, and there, I know that there is a luncheon this week for the Chamber of Commerce. So I don't know how many council members plan on attending that. But.
Okay. Councilmember Odell, do you attend any meetings in Pittsburgh? Or?
Actually, I did, but I don't think you want to hear about them. Okay. All my grandkids. I do have a couple of things I want to mention, though, and I'll try to be brief about it. The first thing is simply to note that tomorrow night at 7 o'clock at the EX3 Teen Center, in other words, the Boys and Girls Club, the IDEA group will be having their monthly meeting. And I encourage anyone who can, has the time to drop in and listen and find out what's going on. Second item, actually fairly relevant to some of the comments we just finished making. I received a communication from the Secretary for the Transportation Infrastructure Committee at the National League of Cities today, to the effect that the U.S. Senate is the leaders of the House Senate and the House Transportation and Infrastructure Committee have gotten together and are going to go forward with a plan for reauthorizing a program called MAP 21, which was the basis for the national transportation funding for the last several years. That, as of the time that some of us went to the National League of Cities meeting in Washington, D.C., was viewed as being roadkill. They are now looking at reauthorizing it to the same level as the last couple of years, adjusted for inflation. So from not having any money possible for roads, we may now have $150 billion plus available on a national basis for road and infrastructure funding. This is the single major source of federal funding left. It includes the Highway Transportation Fund. So I view this as very good news, and I'm looking forward to finding out more about it.
Hey, Councilmember Jaron.
Thank you. I attended a couple of Puget Sound Regional Council-sponsored transportation workshops. One was on emerging transportation technologies, and I think the point was made that technology is changing so rapidly. For example, the first smartphone was sold less than 7 years ago, the first one, and now we're talking. What are we talking, a billion of them or something like that? Mm-hmm. It's incredible how fast the technology is changing, and in the electric car era is upon us. Right now, the projections, some projections for by 2040, it's likely to be 20% of our fleet will be electric, optimistically 40% of the fleet. So technology is changing rapidly. There was a report on automated vehicles, which are coming on quickly also.
I want one.
You want one, huh? Yeah. And then the second one, I was honored to be part of a roundtable session. There are four throughout the state this year, sponsored by the Transportation Commission. And this was a discussion on the Washington State Transportation Plan 2035. And so it sort of ties in with the technology changes. What do we envision for 20 years from now for the state transportation plan? And some good discussions. And one of the safety programs that was introduced some many years ago at PSRC was Target Zero, mainly hoping to have zero deaths by motor vehicle accidents at some time in the future. And at the time, I said, that's ridiculous. We'll never be able to get to zero, so why should you have a target you can't achieve? But now with automated vehicles coming on board, it's conceptually possible. So very interesting sessions, and it's good to see that our state government is looking beyond the next 2 years in terms of transportation planning.
Okay, I'll just mention the Eastside Fire and Rescue Board of Directors meeting last week. Couple of things to mention from that. Obviously, the finances are fine at this point. We're still very early in the year. But we did, one agreement was passed 6-2, I believe, to approve a letter of agreement between the agency and the labor union to allow a personal assignment, what's the last word in that, those three words? Personal assignment, not really a lottery, but it allows the firefighters to put in for changing their station.
Oh, yeah.
They do that about every, well, they used to do it every year. Apparently that was a real mess, but they haven't done one in about 4 years, and so they're gonna do one starting this year, this summer, and so the firefighters will be able to look at changing, you know, getting somewhere closer to home, or maybe getting into a situation that they like better for whatever reasons. There are a number of possibilities. In conjunction with that, you may have heard that the ladder truck station in the Highlands, they're going to have to move the ladder truck from that location, and for various safety reasons. And to do that, they know that means that some of the personnel who are qualified to work on that truck will be making a move. So in conjunction with that, they're also allowing the other firefighters to move around. And they're also going to designate one or two of the, probably the, I'm thinking Carnation and perhaps North Bend would be especially areas too for water rescue. So there may be some people who would want to go there if they have special skills for that, whether it's scuba diving or whatever it is for water rescue. So that was allowed. Again, it was approved 6-2. There was not a whole lot of discussion, but just to, you know, one of the things that will be becoming a big topic as the year goes on is that they're now gearing up for a new labor agreement, and that'll be an important issue over the next year. So that's what I have.
Tom? Yes. Where's the ladder truck going?
One of two places, I think both in Issaquah, but I'm not sure that they've decided which station it would go to at this point. The issue was not that, you know, actually some of our tallest buildings are in the Highlands, but
the narrow streets.
Because of the narrow streets, if that's the first truck that gets there, all the other trucks are blocked. Yeah. So they kind of wanted to be able to get there, but they wanted to be the second or third truck to get there.
Yeah.
So they're gonna start it off a little further away from those those narrow streets. Okay, Deputy Mayor Huckabee.
I did attend ETP along with Bob Keller. It was, to me, it was a very fascinating meeting because Judy Cliburn spoke for almost a half an hour about all of the machinations and attempts to try to get a transportation package passed at the state. She shared a lot of information, and she's done a tremendous amount of work, particularly in trying to educate the Eastern Washington contingent that seems to be opposed to transit and some transportation. And she purposefully brought in to meet with the committee those people who are farmers who are trying to export apples, people who are trying to export grapes, people who are trying to export wine. Export is one of the largest industries in the state, and I was actually surprised to hear her say that they are actually moving away from the Seattle port and are starting to head down to Tacoma and to other areas because of the congestion in the Seattle area. So that has a real significant impact on the economy and the function of our port. So that was quite a surprise. But the long and short of the whole negotiation, and it was just, you know, how typical these things happen. It came down to the decision of if there was going to be a package going forward, and with the construction, there would be some retail excise tax coming out of that, and quite a large lump.
Sales tax,
thank you. Quite a large lump of money. And there was a fight between she and with Ross Hunter about whether that money would go stay in the road budget, because we're one of the few states that has both a general fund and a road budget, or whether it would go to the general fund. And that turned about to be quite an internal battle between the two of them, and that prevented them from coming to an agreement with the Senate. Now, she did say, and was very clear, that she felt that Prop 1 cooled any of the discussions, that they were moving along possibly to make an agreement. But on the other hand, she did admit that when the legislature gathers again together, it may be different people, but it'll probably be the same tenor. And there's entirely a possibility of not getting a transportation budget again in the future. So that was really discouraging for those of us that are very dependent on getting transit money and some transportation money. The other aside was a very interesting conversation with a lot of insight. So I don't hold out a lot of hope for the next legislative session. Now, I understand Rodney Tom is not going to be running, so, you know, depending on how the chairs change, maybe there will be some input for that. The other topic that was discussed was Charlie Howard, along with Judy, talking about the issue of transportation funding in general, and looking at maybe going to a vehicle per mile. And the issue is the same that it is when you talk about tax law changes at the federal level. It's how do you make the transition from one, when you have bonding issues, bonds that have to be paid, to the next type of system, whatever that may be. Charlie did mention that there was going to be a task force being formed, which he said they've been trying to keep quiet and kind of wait to see what the legislature was going to do. But they're going to be forming a task force later this year to look at this broad issue of how we might fund the roads, whether it's VMT, whether it's gas tax, or whether there are some other things that need to be taken into consideration. And they wanted to look pretty far forward in terms of some of these future possibilities. For example, Toyota has announced that it's only going to do hydrogen cars. It's giving up on electric. And so if we have electric and hydrogen and we have natural gas, which is what a lot of the larger vehicles want to do, mm-hmm. and then now you have Amazon wanting to do drones and take their trucks off the road altogether, there are some really interesting, and I was being a bit facetious when I asked him if he was going to have a psychologist on there too. But it'll be really interesting to see what they choose for topics and how they formulate the questions as the type of answers that will get out of that particular task force. And they hope to have that in place by the end of the year and then working through next year. And I'll remember that letter. I can't recall what it is. It's coming.
We could bring it to our next meeting.
Well, it's coming to PIC, and it has to do. It's a letter to the legislature, basically, to get off the stick and get something done.
I'll bring it to the meeting.
Get off the stick, and it's also technical language.
Also, yeah, very technical language. So that was ETP. Some very interesting things, because ETP is kind of trying to figure out what it wants to be when it grows up. And so there are constant calls for having some sense of what is ETP's role and what is ETP's role in supporting the transportation changes in the legislature and how we might influence that a little bit better. So I thought I might throw my hat in the ring and see where we'd be going on that. The other thing that I wanted to talk about was the urban wildlife designation. Mm-hmm. And I did stick a written note in here. But I also talked to Eileen Stahl today. She mentioned this morning that there's an interest in the part of those folks that are working on that designation, bringing somebody to talk to not only the council, but the maybe a joint meeting with the council and the planning commission. And I've asked her to send me an email so I can forward it on to you to see what we can do and how we could perhaps put that on the agenda going forward. And the last thing I wanted to mention is I read the Sammamish Review tonight. And if you haven't read it, there was an article featuring our own beer distiller who is making beer at their home, but they are looking for a commercial site in Sammamish. So I hope, city manager, you find them a place.
Well, the park should be suitable.
Yeah. But it was fun to read. So hopefully we'll be able to find them a place where they can stay here.
Okay, Councilmember Valderrama.
Yes, last week I attended the Citizens for Sammamish meeting with Councilmember Gerrand, as well as Tim Larson from staff and Planning Commission members, and they had covered two major topic areas. One, which was covered, was the Lake Washington School District bond, citing concerns that they have that Seattle Times and Kirkland Council had cited as far as what is the real cost of it for the average household. Is it $125, $330, or is Kirkland Council that asked for $404? I understand that Kirkland, a few weeks ago, when they presented their council, Lake Washington School District, that they would go back and update to figure out the mathematics that were involved in there. There was also a concern raised by our citizens as to why no schools in Sammamish were included into this. And finally, that the bond's been split into two parts going on that. The other issue that there was raised there, and there were Northeast Water District Commissioners also present, was the Northeast Water District, and Council Member Jern and I got a handful of information, first-hand information from the citizens, which to me surprised me, I think, to share with you all, was the intensity of the citizens and the number of them coming forward from homeowners associations and grassroots initiatives that we will have to look at and see how do we better address some of these concerns that they have. There seems to be made very clearly, if you agree with me, Councilman Jaron, a trust issue, which I don't see where it's coming from, that they don't trust the city, and I'm not sure where that comes from.
It's coming from the distrust at the federal level and the state level.
All right. Well, that was the 2 points that were made there. Also, I saw in the Issaquah Reporter that next week they're supposed to begin work on the East Lake Sammamish Trail. On the north end of that is in our city. I had asked previously that we have an update on that trail project taking place in our city, so I would hope that we would get sooner rather than later, since that work's beginning, an update, since it is under our jurisdiction.
Ask that update, Mr. Walter.
Yeah, you did ask, but I want to correct that. It's in our jurisdiction, but it's not under our jurisdiction.
I understand. Okay. It is in our jurisdiction. That's what
but
I
you said.
Said
under our jurisdiction.
Well, we're permitting it to them. It is in our city, and we're permitting it.
I know. I just wanted to make it clear that we are not doing the permitting.
Oh, we are doing the permitting.
They under our jurisdiction.
Oh, no. We are doing the permitting. To be clear, the city
processes.
That's correct.
We're processing.
Exactly. So yep. We are processing the permit in our city.
Well, I don't want people writing to us saying that we want you to do this, that, or the other thing, because we don't have that capability.
Too late.
Too late. So take it back.
So the other point is just to say happy Passover, and since we're not going to be here, happy Easter to everybody. It's Sammamish and Klein.
And Issaquah.
And Issaquah.
Yeah. Councilmember Whitten. Okay, that finishes council reports. City manager.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. A couple reports. One is very quick. The other one is going to take some time, so be patient, if you could, please. The easy one is that I sent you guys a letter today, an email, and this is the letter that's supporting Mountain to Sounds Greenway Initiative, that they're requesting recognition by federal government designated as a National Heritage Area. We supported this program in the past. I think we should be supporting them to get that recognition from the federal government. And I haven't heard any objections from any one of you. So I'm going to ask Mayor to sign that letter.
Any thoughts? Objection?
Thank you very much.
Thank you. We'll sign it at the end of the meeting.
Thank you. Second one is that in the past, council asked a question about the Sammamish Landing pedestrian crossing options. The work strike is a report to present.
about, you know, she, that I think that crossing over crossing is a very expensive option, but maybe that grade crossing may be the better options. Unless we spend a lot of money.
Ben, I think you just gave my whole presentation.
All right. There you go, Laura. Go for it.
We did come to the council in last month, and there were some questions about how we were going to get pedestrians from the parking lot to the park. So Sammamish Landing Phase 2, bike orientation. I'm going to try to step through this kind of quickly because of the time of the night. So if I go too fast, please interrupt and stop me. Here's the green parcels. Here is where the parking lot is proposed. Across East Lake Sammamish Parkway is the park Sammamish Landing. There are three viable options that we considered. One is a bridge or an overpass tunnel under the roadway, or a crosswalk, which is at grade, not a simple crosswalk, but with some enhancements. Pedestrian bridge, some of the pros are it does completely separate the pedestrians from the vehicles. So obviously that's a positive, reduces delays for vehicles. There's the spot for pedestrians crossing. Some challenges are users often avoid it if alternatives exist. ADA access would be required, and there's about a 20-25 foot grade difference between East Lake Sammamish Parkway and the trail or the entrance to the park. Existing topography on the east side of the roadway. And it's very expensive. And this picture's in here just to show you that this was actually in Maryland, this bridge, but they did a study. 50% of the pedestrians don't use the bridge just because it takes effort to go up, so they choose to go underneath. So there's a lot of money spent and potentially not utilized. Just to show quickly some of the grade challenges. East Lake Sammamish Parkway, as I said, is up here and down to the trails, about 20-25 feet vertical elevation. So it's approximately a 50% slope to go here. So you're having some kind of way to get accessible, you know, all folks to have the ability, not to mention beyond ADA, you're going to have people who want to use big coolers and whatnot. So we need to have some way to get people up that elevation. And then on this side, on the east side of the parkway, the roadway or the land slopes up. So again, you're going to have a little bit less distance down to the parking lot, but you'll still need to have enough room to have a ramp so folks can get up to there. The pedestrian bridge cost is approximately $1.2 million. It is potential. This is the layout we have currently. The land slopes up relatively steeply, and then there's a little bit of a bench, and then it slopes again. The parking lot is currently planned for the flattest part of the parcels with walls along the back side of the parking lot up to 8 feet. They're pushing that further to the east to make more ramps, and those walls are going to get bigger, and the parking lot costs will get larger. So the cost of $1.2 million does not include any changes to the parking lot costs. It also doesn't include what a cost of an elevator might be if we had to use an elevator on the west side of the parkway. Pedestrian underpass, some of the pros again, separating the pedestrians from vehicles, another positive, it reduces the delays for vehicles. A nice thing is it does work out nicely on the park side, because you come out from underneath, you don't have that large grade to drop. West side, the grades would work nicely. Challenges, low visibility. Some people aren't comfortable. We've heard it on the 187th undercrossing and under 2. Other areas that we've heard of, people feel vulnerable in a tunnel or an undercrossing area. The topography on the parking lot side, we've had the same issue that I show with the over the pedestrian bridge, potentially pushing the parking lot to the east. Falls, and it would have to push it further than you would for the overcrossing, because in order to get enough, there would be underground utility conflicts. There's some major utilities about 10 feet below the roadway, meaning we'd have to get down below those. utilities or digging into that deep and under the roadway. We're talking about some significant traffic control and impacts. And it's very expensive. Just show the parking lot again after we're up the hill, you know, but it would be nice, come out nicely out on the trail. It cost $1.1 million was the cost estimate for the Oasis Bridge underpassing. Again, this cost is not, does not include impacts to the parking lot costs. Announced crosswalk is the third option. We looked at the at-grade crossing. We would not recommend just painting a crosswalk across the roadway without any kind of safety enhancements. What we have looked at and settled on is the best alternative for the at-grade crossing option is what's called a rectangular rapid flashing beacon, RR. Very creative title, but it is. These are being utilized all over the nation. They are pedestrian.
Around what?
They are pedestrian.
I thought Cameron
activated.
Had left.
So, pedestrian has to push a button in order to activate them. They are quite bright and very, very visible for drivers. A painted crosswalk would be included as well. Refuge Island. The idea is that you walk only across one lane, stop, and then you cross the second lane. Here's a picture of an RRFB. Just an example of what I'm positive. This has been listed as a an option. Washington State has their Strategic Highway Safety Plan 2013, and they have a target zero fatalities in the state of Washington vehicular. And they list that these rectangular rapid flashing beacons as suggested use relatively new. They have not new, but they are newer and they have great results. Federal Highway Highway Administration also recommends that they are approved in the manual of uniform traffic control devices, and they're listed in a number of master plans around some large cities around.
I was on Marco Island in Florida 2 or 3 years ago, and they had the hotel on the ocean on one side, and then crossed a major, you know, sort of like the road to Kirkland, to a shopping center on the other side where they had grocery stores and restaurants. And much better than what you see here. Better between two poles that you ran, and everything flashed, lit up high, and then it beeped. Very, very effective. Nobody, and you know, part of they don't stop for pedestrians. I wish you would look into this one particular type that they used there. Very, very effective. Nobody could miss it.
I think.
But this one, they have one car.
Unfortunately, we got too, you know, so many things on our plate that she probably didn't have a chance to show in graphically what she described to you. And that is, there will be an island, so the pedestrian will be only negotiating crossing one lane of the traffic, will come to the island, and then they will be looking at the only one other direction. So much safer, you're not dealing with both directions of the traffic simultaneously, as what you see in this traffic, in this crossing here. Doesn't have the island there.
I do have a couple more photos.
Oh my God, you sure? So long.
So successful examples in Sammamish ourselves. We have one on East Lake Sammamish Parkway, just north of Northeast 18th Place. We have one on 244th in front of Rachel Carson. We used to have the end on near Beaver Lake Middle School. We used to have the in-pavement flashers. We continuously had problems over and over and over and over again. So we got tired of the maintenance, and that's when we actually looked into these rectangular rapid flashing beacons. And then here's a picture that is more similar to what Council or island. The idea is you cross the one island at an angle in the middle so that you're turned and you're actually looking at the direction of the driver's eye contact before you cross the coast lane. That was in Kirkland. Medina is using the nines. Drake is using the number of other locations around. The pros, they are pedestrian activated, so they're not flashing all the time. As you know, if you had a sign that just flashes, like I think Kirkland used them traditionally. School is flash 24 hours a day. Drivers become complacent, they don't stand out. So there is a high, they're very visible, there's a high driver compliance, and it does minimize vehicular delays because you don't have, if it's a full traffic signal and it turns, actually crossing, they cross really fast, and vehicles, it's less expensive than the other options that I've shared with you tonight. Challenges are there is still requires pedestrian and driver alertness and awareness. Cars and vehicles still have to have some interaction. There is some delay to motorists. It's not like the undercrossing or overcrossing where they're completely. And then it is possible. Although there is that where we haven't, all the agencies we've talked to or history associated possibility. Cost-wise, $65,000 in order to put these signs in the pedestrian refuge island. A comparison cost is included in the project scope that has been was shared. In summary, here are the costs for the three options.
We can do two of them.
We can do 10 of them.
So, just wanted to share this, and there is always opportunity that with at-grade crossings to on the consent agenda this evening, you approve of some our signs, if you will, on either side of this area that I believe is an important addition with or without the parking lot. It's just when drivers drive by them, it'll be further out. When drivers drive by, they will light up, and drivers that are entering into high activity zone, they're utilized for Westlake Sammamish for the speed limit sign. Had an opportunity to drive by those signs, they really grab your attention. They're, I didn't use them here, we think that and paired with the enhanced crosswalk.
You might be happier, so I'm assuming that we're going with the enhanced great crosswalk in this.
Yeah, Deputy Mayor Huckabee, you had a question?
On the enhanced crosswalk, island in the middle, at our gate, so walk in and then walk in on one side and walk in on the other.
So the pedestrians would have a refuge.
Okay, we have consensus on that. Councilmember O'Dell, you had a question?
I had a question. Could you go back to the overhead shot on the parking lot?
Of the new, with the new parking lot overlay?
Yeah. looking at that, is there a very steep drop off? I think there's quite a steep drop off where the crosswalk would come, right?
This is... Part of the project included down from the parkway and an ADA accessible ramp on this side.
Okay.
That was already included in the project scope that was approved by the council.
I like the idea of the center island with some protection, like Kathy was just talking about. Maybe a couple of big boulders too. But with a flashing light on it so people know it's there. But I'm just wondering, do you really have enough space there to build a substantial island?
Yes, we have some space to minor widening over here by tight lining the ditch. 30% design right now. We have the space to do some transitioning. We are already restricting the on-street parking in a good section through here because of site distance, and we'll actually get worse by adding the driveway, so we need to make sure we keep site distance around those driveways.
Councilmember Keller?
I am going to follow up on the $65,000 cost. Does that include all this, or is that something else?
Well, the widening has to happen, so it's kind of it's a combination of things for asphalt widening that is associated with the work over here for getting connecting. There's, if you recall, we're putting in some accessible parking stalls over here at work, so some of that would occur with or without the refuge island going in.
Okay.
First, thank you very much for taking us here. First of all, how will it affect the traffic? I mean, just like Sammamish.
I don't expect it to be substantial. We have crosswalks in other places. And if you've been through this area in the last couple, well, this last summer when we had some hot days where we had vehicles kind of parked all over and pedestrians walking across in uncontrolled and unfunneled locations, that one's probably more impactful to the traffic because you never really knew where it was going to happen and you were stopping at multiple places, whereas this will be more controlled. And because
the way it is, it's not a traffic signal. So if you have a traffic signal that actually does the, red light, we have to time it such that the slowest person can cross. And so that's relatively slow. I'm sure you've all experienced where somebody pushes the button, they run across the street, and then you get to sit there for a minute and a half while the countdown occurs. And so that, because this is more, it doesn't stop them, it shows them that there's a pedestrian, the vehicles yield, and once the pedestrian has crossed, then the vehicles have the right to go again. So it does minimize that.
Okay. Councilmember Valderrama?
Yeah, I was just going to reiterate a point that Laura had made earlier on, that this already does exist on East Lake Sammamish Parkway on the between Northeast 18th and 19th Street is where it exists.
Yeah.
So the people driving East Lake Sammamish Parkway every day are already familiar with these lights and seeing them come on. I'm surprised you don't have a picture of that out there because it is a pretty bright light that exists there.
So for the traffic pattern and doing that, they're already accustomed on that road to seeing it, and I'm glad to see that to go forward as we address it, and just wanted to make sure that everybody was aware of that.
Councilmember Whitten.
Is crossing not in the crosswalk going to be an issue? And if it is, are you going to put any kind of barriers up to force them to go under the...
You know, when you put in crosswalks, the idea is to put them in desired lines. And here we have a clear desire line, a parking lot and a park. We can't control 100% of every street in the city where people may or may not choose to cross. Part of that, I mean, we have that example all along the parkway where people want to get down to the trail. And so we've had requests for, you know, a crosswalk for one or two homes, but if you put in a crosswalk for every single, it would be unattainable. But I think that this parking lot is really going to solve a lot of those issues, because the I'd say 95% of the time the vehicles will be parking in the parking lot rather than parking along the parkway. Thank you.
Okay. I guess we're good?
Got a head nod on this one, so.
I think so.
Yes.
Okay.
Great ideas.
Yeah.
Great. Thank you.
Okay.
That concludes the city manager's report.
All right. Well, then we come to no executive session, so do I have a motion to adjourn?
So move.
We have a second.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
We're adjourned.
Tom, you want this back?
No, it's yours.
Thank you.